Good evening. This is a Wednesday, April 6th, 2016 at 6:32 or so, meeting of the Board of Selectmen, joint with the Finance Committee for discussions, held at 8 Conway Street in the village of South Deerfield. I think, have you got a quorum? Do you want to get started? The agenda listed that we were going to meet at 7 o'clock in a joint meeting with the Finance Committee. They're all present, and the hearing that we were going to have is canceled, so we're going to move them forward. I'm sure that we'll still be here at 7 o'clock, so if people want to show up and ask questions, it would be probably appropriate at that time, and we can revisit anything that's necessary.
If I may, Chairman, Dylan, did you, your meeting was posted for 6:30?
Right.
Okay, so you can legally call your meeting to order.
Okay.
Excellent.
All right.
Thank you.
Just want to make
that
sure
makes it all legal.
Yeah, now absolutely.
Now we're just joining their meeting.
I'll officially bring the Finance Committee meeting to order at 6:30 here in South Deerfield. We have a quorum. And I think this is all that we're going to have for tonight. So thanks, guys, for having us.
Thanks for coming in.
For coming. I appreciate the fact that you guys are here tonight. Thank you.
Especially after spending here last night.
I know.
Yes. Well, thanks to Doug, who's here both. Doug, I had shot you a few possible topics. I don't know if you had...
I did not have a chance to print them, but I can.
No need. I just didn't know if there are other ones or thoughts.
Since you guys have the most recent discussions, we'd rather start with your, go ahead and
Sure.
get your list and we'll go from there.
Okay, perfect.
I think you pretty much touched on everything that I had on my list as well, so.
Okay.
Did you have OPEB on your list?
I did.
Then that was it.
Okay.
Good.
All right, well, like I said, thanks for having us, and we very much understand that there's a budget process where you guys have the things that you do, and you've done a lot of them, and we have the things that we do, and we've done most of them, and we'll finish up our work. And the point of this meeting isn't to, for me at least, to talk about disagreements on specific line items. That's what our recommendations in town meeting is for. But I thought this would be helpful to talk about bigger picture issues or things that are a little bit more complicated than just one line item and just one budget. So I guess since Doug mentioned it, I don't really have a particular order. I'd start with OPEB, and the thing I just wanted to bring up on that one is not so much the particular amount of money we may want to or not want to put away this year towards it, but is there a longer-term plan, you know, kind of where are we heading big picture on that? I think we generally kind of know what it's for and at least have seen some numbers on, you know, kind of the sizes of the issue and when it may come become more real, but what are your guys' thoughts on kind of what this money, whatever we do put in, is building towards and how you'd see it setting up, or are we still trying to feel our way through it?
Well, I think it's hugely important, you know, because it's a liability that we have. But we disagree on the amounts, Mark and I do. And so I've just backed off being worried about it. I mean, I was totally appalled last year when, you know, I found out last budget year. You know, I found out how serious it was. Mm-hmm. So I've decided myself personally not to get so worried about it and wait until we, I think Barbara says it's this next year that we have to do the mandatory, you know, it's like a bigger audit.
GASB 74.
And the change, is it being listed as a liability of the town? Is that the change coming?
So what they will do is they will, the account, the CPA kind of persons, will decide what our liability is, and then there's no discussion, and then we will then decide how we're going to finance it.
Okay.
At that point, I just didn't want to argue. We're not putting anything aside. Mark wants to put something towards it, and I'm fine with that. But the amount, I'm just not going to worry about. We'll get an official notification because you can have someone do it, but I think the estimate was $3,500, and it's like, let's put $3,500 towards it and not spend
right.
it to have someone tell us how much we owe. So, and we have to pay for this anyway, this
right.
review, so let them come up with an amount of money that we owe, supposedly, and it will be official. Then we can figure out how to move forward. I mean, that's sort of where I'm coming from. I'm kind of backed off. I was really spazzy last year, as you remember, and because it was just
new budget, new year,
right? Well, it was just such a huge amount of money, and it's just hanging out there. But actually, you know, everybody has this huge amounts of money, and nobody's really funding it adequately. So, why should we, you know, impact our operations until we know exactly how to do it, and then figure out something?
Right.
You know, it's going to be a lot of discussion.
Right.
I don't know.
Even after the first year gets done, it's going to be interpretive.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't see these accountants coming out and hitting a home run with all skills and knowledge. They're going to all look at it, and you're going to get numbers across the board, high, low, medium. If they all come up with real good numbers and they have a plan, then it should be just a cakewalk for us. We're covering what our requirements are now.
On a cash
basis. In the cash aspect, we're paying for everything that we've got. The big issue is, and if you really look at it, the big issue is when it starts impacting our budgets so that it takes line items off of our ability to do work because we have to pay these cash monies is where we really have to start crunching. We're at a point now where we have enough time, I think, to make sure that we adequately fund it when we know what it is and what it looks like when we reach that.
Yeah.
A lot of our monies that are in that arena have already been tweaked some, and hopefully we've anticipated well enough. But if we haven't, then we'll have to come up with a financial plan and make it work.
I just got so crazy because it was such a huge amount.
Started the process and, put the account aside to make it work. And then, sure, I think we should put some seed money in there. I don't want to go crazy because I don't want us to overcommit money. But I want to put some money in there so that as the auditors look at it, they're not looking for somebody who's just thumbing their nose at the process, but really wanting to know where to go before we start making any major commitments. And I think that's a token effort for what we need to do.
It just is such a huge amount of money, and that's why I was crazy last year.
So have you got anything more to offer?
Nothing's changed.
Have you guys done any research and got us any information as to what you think we should be looking at or doing?
Sure. I disagreed.
So I guess...
We didn't come to any agreement.
There was a variety of opinions about how much we may want to fund this year, ranging from, I think, the fully requested amount to zero, so the full range of possibilities among the committee members. I'll speak for myself. For me, the thing that I think, Carolyn, that your concern is well-placed as to how big these numbers are. These are big numbers, and they're not all due this year, so there is time, but they're big enough that you do have to start planning in anticipation of them rather than let them kind of fall upon you at some point in the future. The concern that I have about this, and it's not specific to OPEB, it seems that there's a push, not from the town, but to set up capital investments to try to reduce the ultimate costs of things like OPEB. And that's where some of these estimates assume some rate of return on investment of money that you'd set aside now and invest and ultimately be able to pay some or all of the annual OPEB costs from that capital. And I've said this before, I don't believe that the role of government is to raise tax dollars to set aside and invest in whatever. And it's not about who's doing it or bad investments. I just don't think that's what we are here to do. And so my disagreement is more from that angle than, well, we need X thousand dollars for something else, which is a totally separate and valid conversation. So I guess that's my concern, is that the big picture direction we're going? Are we trying to raise, and I think, Doug, you'd use a term like a scholarship fund that raises money over time and then has enough money that can then fund something on an annual basis? Because that's something I'd want to know just as a voter before putting any money into it, if that's what we're doing, or if we're not doing that, what are we doing? And if we're really just trying to set aside cash just because we don't know where this is going to lead, or a bond, you know, if we're looking to bond, they may look at that liability and be concerned, then I think we could set aside money into stabilization or any number of other places that could accomplish a similar thing. So I guess that is kind of where I'm coming from on it, and that's my feeling about why at this point I haven't really been supportive of putting money aside in that specific OPEB account, because that's where it seems to lead.
And that's why I kind of backed off, because we not only can we not, we know it's a large number, but we can't really figure, I mean, given the fact that we are having trouble just covering our operational budget, it seems ridiculous to be paying, you know, out of our taxes to put away so much like that and just let it sit. So I don't know. I mean, there's going to be, I think we should have a joint meeting at some point after we get the final, you know, some kind of numbers that are confirmed by professionals, and, you know, try to just figure out how we're going to do it. I mean, I feel like we should have set an OPEB meeting all by itself.
Well, by the time they come up with that, they're going to have best practices written, even though they have no experience to do it by, but they will give us best practices, and we can just pick what we think are the best practices for us to work through. But at that point in time, we'll know more of what we're discussing. Right now, it's they're all over the board. And don't get me wrong, we 15 years ago established accounts that put money aside for things like this, emergency vacation, sick time, things of that nature, to support our people. And basically we had a sufficient amount of money for back then. If we had rolled it into an account, we probably would have enough to cover OPEB, but the auditors swiped it back into the general fund because they said it was illegal and it wasn't valid. Now they're asking us to do the same thing for another reason, but it's no more lesser more illegal than what the legislature is going to allow us to do. So I think it's premature for us to get caught up in the weeds of how we're going to get there. I agree with your philosophy. I think that we need to have a financial plan as to whether we use it as a, as you said, seed money to invest, or we just keep it in stabilization or some funds that earmarks the money for that. There's got to be a point in which best practices tells us is the way that that municipality should be handling this, because it's going to be all over the board.
Right. I mean, you know, and to Carolyn's point earlier, the nightmare scenario for me is you end up in a position where you've got money kind of put away into OPEB that then can only be used for that, and you're going to end up laying someone off so you can fund their health care and their retirement. Like, you know, it's really, you could be faced with some really odd choices when you're looking at your budget. That's the case. I don't know the restrictions on that fund, but that's my concern about putting money in, is I don't know.
The funds, and the reason I went for a small amount is the funds are to stay in that account. No matter, you know, once you put it in there, it stays there for that purpose.
Yeah.
To the best of my knowledge, that's the way we created it, is the way they explained it to me. So basically, it's in there. And if we overfund it, we just, the next time we don't have to put money in there. If
I don't think underfunding it's going to be a problem.
I don't think so either.
Was there any point in good faith to have just a small amount in there or not?
Yes, it's just a good faith effort showing that you, I mean, we put the legislative, or we put the article on town meeting floor to show good faith that we believe that we need to make sure that we address this.
Didn't you, John, one time suggest just a small amount in it? I think way back a year or so ago when we were talking about that.
That's what we talked about. He was putting in like $1,000 or $5,000 just to seed it, and that's it.
Seed money, but no.
Question, once we start down this road, are the auditors going to be looking at us to be increasing on an annual basis, or at least contributing on an annual basis? Or is it a situation once you start the seed money, is it, you know, come budget time and all of a sudden we're crunching numbers and it's not working, is this a account that we can set aside and go zero on it?
Right now there's no mandatory set aside. What the penalty is right now is if you went, and it's not even really yet, but it's if you went to borrow money and you're bonding, that's part of your bonding profile, and to get the lowest rates.
But that's just going to be your liability, which if you have assets of any kind, whether they're stabilization or free cash, you're going to offset that regardless of kind of what pocket that.
In if we go to the FDA or some of those organizations, they have a checklist. Mm-hmm. And this is a block, and it's supposedly going to be a block in that checklist. It's not that you have a lot of money as an asset. They're going to be looking at that for rating also.
Okay.
But this is one of those things where you get moved.
Well, I'd be happy to put a dollar in to check the box.
Huh?
I'd be happy to put a dollar in to check the box if that's all we need to do.
Well, we should put something in it, but just because we know or we hope to go get rural USDA loan.
Right. And I know so, that is a very real concern. That's why I thought this is really
so
important.
So right now there's because there's so many communities across 351 communities. Only a handful have really done anything. So everybody else is non-compliant. Mm-hmm. And so everybody's starting. The state hasn't done anything mandatory because it would bankrupt everybody. I mean, our liability, you know, is close, in my mind, we can disagree, Mark, but it's well over $1 million, okay? It's more like $1.5 million from what I can estimate. But, and from, you know, the calculations. But some of these communities have, you know, tens of millions of dollars. And so, you know, it's really awful. So, I mean, we're very conservative. I mean, ours is very small in relative terms. So that's why there's no penalties really yet.
Was this just an overlooked thing or just kind of set aside or?
I think so, because you know what? I never even heard of it before until we went to, not this year, but the year before.
The reason why is, when this all started, you had low wages and low benefits for them.
Right.
The higher and more professional people you put into government, the higher the pay salary is and the bigger the things are. We didn't plan for that jump, that magnitude of jump to
goes
go from
almost
volunteers to professionals. Mm-hmm. And I think the model, as she said, everybody in the state is in the same boat because model for that transition didn't really exist.
Well, and it's health insurance related, and health insurance used to be relatively cheap as part of your benefit package. But now, you know, it's getting to be such an expensive item, and, you know, everybody's trying to handle it the best way possible, but it's a huge liability, and I think that's really how the calculation came out, is that it's, you know, the long-term cost of...
Trust me, I'm not being critical. I'm just curious how...
Well, that's...
You know, just,
well, it was brand new to me, let me tell you. Yeah. And everybody was talking about it. It was one of those workshops you went to, and everybody was just, you know, their mouth was hanging open. This is like new information. This is a couple of years, you know, not this past year, but last year. Year before, I mean. And it... you know, when we looked at our numbers, it was just like, you have got to be kidding me. This is like brand new all of a sudden, you know.
Part of the unbelievable portion for me, the part that makes me cautious, and I don't disagree with Carolyn, even though she says I do all the time. I basically have a different mindset or how I want to analyze things. The school paid to have somebody go through and do their numbers, and they came in at...
Well, Frontier was like... What was that? It was over $1 million.
Yeah, I remember
million
that.
Three,
okay,
million
so you have a $1 million entity over there at twice what our base salaries are. You know, not base salaries per person, but the outcome for that entity. They have more employees than we have.
Yeah, right.
Their liability is $1 million. Mm-hmm. I have a hard time stretching my mind to figure how theirs can only be $1 million and ours is 1.5. And don't, it's not argumentative. I mean, it's my way of thinking. I'm not saying anybody's right or wrong.
Yeah.
And what I'm saying is that basically, until we get our arms around this thing, it doesn't make sense to go out for the $1 million transfer to an account. But it doesn't hurt anything to acknowledge that we have an issue, and it's going to be bigger than a dollar or $500 or $15 or whatever arbitrary number you want to put in there. And to be honest with you, I'm gonna recommend that we put $50,000 or whatever we put in our number. Is it 25 or 50?
It's 50.
50?
Oh, what?
It's 50 in the
list. 50.
Oh, do we put it up to 50?
And
okay.
The discussion can happen on floor and take it down to whatever
right.
It wants to be.
Right.
I'm not going to stand up there and be a proponent of it.
No, and that's not what we're here for tonight, is to go right. Talking about the underlying.
Right.
So we're looking for the big picture.
Yep.
But this big picture, I think, is like so many others, it's not clear. And I don't care how many times you develop the film, you're not going to get any better picture than we have right now.
Do we have a gut feeling for what our exposure present day is as far as active retirees? I mean, we're paying out something now, right?
Right.
Well,
I think the last time I looked at the insurance numbers, please forgive me, Barbara, if you're out there watching tonight, this is off the top of my head, somewhere between $150,000 and $300,000 per year. I think it's much on the low end of that scale, between $150,000 and $200,000 per year of our insurance costs are related to retirees' benefits. I think it's honestly around 150
okay.
Per year. Feeding into that, the liability exposure that was discussed on the state level was in relation to cities or large municipal governments where they have a much larger workforce, a workforce that exceeds the entire population of Deerfield, and they're trying to come up with a liability post-employment benefit liability for that size of a workforce. You know, if you're talking about the University of Massachusetts, the numbers are astronomical. I personally believe that they're not going to ask the town of Deerfield to set aside an amount equal to half again its annual budget just to be able to get interest off of that in order to pay $150,000 a year, or whatever the numbers work out to be. I'm thinking that there's going to be hybrid options, where perhaps we set aside a couple of $100,000 into an OPEB stabilization account. We don't touch it, and it can only be used for post-employment benefits costs. Set up a policy that funds these costs through our regular budget up to a certain level, for example, and that could be a percentage of the annual budget or some mechanism, mm-hmm. and set up a policy which tells you and the board how to manage OPEB costs. And so literally it's a function of following the rules, following the formulas, and making sure that you feed into that stabilization fund if you take from it. Otherwise, it just sits there. And that's our insurance policy.
Mm-hmm.
It could be that kind of mechanism will be something that would be approved for smaller entities.
It could be an insurance policy that you subwrite.
But right now we're chasing clouds. We have no idea what things are going to look like.
But it's not going away. That's the key thing.
It's going to continue to be talked about. I can tell you that since it has been talked about over the past 6 months, I've received several emails through the town's email address from investors wanting to handle our OPEB investments. That's never a good thing. It's never a good thing when somebody's immediately turning it into
I'm almost positive the people that derived this thing had this in mind when they started. This would be a nice way to start another cottage industry to basically get more money out of the process. But again, it's a wait and see as far as I'm concerned, but I don't feel that being prudent and showing our good faith is something that's going to hurt us in the long run. The money's always going to be there, and I guarantee you that at some point in time we're going to owe $50,000 or whatever the number is, $5, $10. I don't mind. So whatever you guys recommend, I'm probably going to not say word one to it.
It's a drop in the bucket.
If you put less than a buck, I'd probably say something.
Well, it's a drop in the bucket on the OPEB thing, and that's where it gets tougher. If it's not a drop in the bucket compared to some of the other stuff we're contemplating pulling back from or not doing. And so that's on our end of what we're voting, but that's kind of where we had a range of opinions. But we'll go back next week and go through that and come up with a number that we recommend.
I would rather have us cut that because we don't have a definitive number and we don't have a definitive plan.
Right.
So let's just move on and then deal with it next year.
Unless the board wishes to make a decision about that now.
I'd rather have the finance people weigh in on it.
Yeah, I would rather have us look at the budget and figure out.
I know the big.
That's what we'll do. We'll have our next meeting.
I understand that, but
if you
guys discussed it a lot more, then just give us a
number.
Okay.
Just for my own clarification, so I don't pull my hair out on Tuesday.
You may anyway.
Together, the public hearing. If the finance committee actually decide on a number, if let's say they say this should be $25,000. No, I'm pulling that out of
sure.
If they say that we recommend $25,000, Would you generally agree with that and
oh, yeah.
want it to be put into the budget?
I'm fine with that.
Yep. And I, again, I just pulled the number out of thin air, the $25,000. They might recommend a dollar, so who knows?
We'll be voting it on Monday. Okay. You can relate that to them, whatever you guys want to do with it from there.
Yep.
Because if reducing the OPEB funding makes a difference in other finance committee recommendations for other budgets, I would certainly want to make sure that you guys are working with them as best as possible.
I, like I said, I would rather, since we do not have a definitive number,
right.
we don't have a definitive plan, to just throw money in there. I'm really not spazzy anymore. It's not going away, but we do have some time to deal with it. So
okay.
I would rather have us have a good budget
right.
and then worry about the OPEB next year and focus on that as a, you know, as we try to figure out an overall long-term plan.
Okay. Well,
it makes sense.
Thank you. We'll do our thing.
Okay.
We'll report our results back to Doug and we can take it from
and
there.
I hope it doesn't sound wishy-washy.
No, it doesn't. No. This is what this issue is like. This is not definitive yet.
Wishy-washy.
No, but it is.
Our like, this is last night. So.
Yeah.
Well, it's just, you know, it's such a large number. And I really was crazy last year because it seemed like people were starting to deal with it and we weren't. And I was upset, but, you know, further conversations, people actually aren't dealing with it, and they don't have plans, and I certainly did not want to pay money to get an answer sooner than we had to get an answer. It just didn't make sense.
I agree with that 100%. Right. Okay, if unless anyone has something else on that, the next issue that had come up in our conversations a couple times was the COLAs for the Step 10 employees, and not so much... We didn't really talk about if we love or hate the number that's been put into the budget, the 1.7, but I just thought for tonight it'd be interesting, like, is there some sort of framework, like, in my mind it would be some sort of a range from this percent to this percent, and if certain indicators you look at are on the high end, then it's at the higher end of the range, and if certain things you're looking at are on the low end, it's a lower end of the range. Is there some process like that, and is there a process that that's set up? Is it with you guys, the personnel board? We just didn't know.
Basically, there's a process that's set up that hasn't been followed very well.
Okay.
And it's at the discretion of the department head to propose what is the recommended raise for somebody at step 10 because it's above and beyond what the range of fair market value is for the employee. So my recollection of 8 years ago was it was the onus was put on the department head to show the worth of the people that are being recommended to go into what we called a bonus or a area above that's a step 10 plus. Sorry about this.
No worries.
In the past, it hasn't really been challenged or thought through the process. In the last 2 years, we've been looking at, because our fair market values have not been reviewed for a period of time, we're looking at what are the fair market value of our employees and try to make the scale into that range so that employees stay within the 1 to 10. There are going to be cases where somebody's been doing a job for 5 or 6 years and basically they have no more to offer the town because they could hire somebody of that same skill for less money that is going to stay there because they want to stay there and they don't want to move on to a better job or they don't want to, you know, get a better education or do something, but they really like what they're doing and they're willing to stay at the pay rate they're at until such time that they decide they want to be moved on or we come up with different work for them to do. It's not fair to have the taxpayers pay money for something that is could be done by cheaper labor or cheaper thought processes. So that's the mindset behind it. And that has nothing to do with any individual or any person. That's that 90-mile overview that you were talking about. This is how it's supposed to work. So we've commissioned some studies, and we've looked at some ways, and we've got the personnel committee looking at how to revamp it as such. It may mean that we're going to come back at some point and look for money to actually put together a plan or a policy to do the writing of it. but we're still within the guides of what was set out 9 years ago. And at the time, it was scheduled to be reviewed every 7 years. So we're a couple years behind the queue.
I'm sorry, I just want to make sure. It seems like you're speaking more about the classification schedule than the Step 10 Plus, which is another important issue, I agree.
It's of the same thing, because we have no COLA requirements in the program at all.
Right.
The classification system is based just upon people staying within their net worth.
But everybody moves value up a step every year, right? I guess I didn't understand the part about someone staying at a certain level.
If somebody does not perform, they should not move up a step.
Exactly.
Has that happened?
Just twice that I know of.
That process is dependent upon annual performance reviews of every employee, as well as annual performance reviews of managers of departments. There's one department that does that consistently on a biannual basis, or a semiannual basis?
Semiannual.
So every 6 months. And that's the police department.
Okay.
And that's done that way because the collective bargaining agreement for the police department mandates that it be done.
And we set that up as the model that was supposed to be done here.
Uh-huh.
And we've never been able to get it kicked off the ground because there's an awkwardness between elected people evaluating people that they see in passing ships on their performances. So we do it, and you can't meet together, so we can't start the process down. And it never got kicked off because we never got, not Doug, but that chair to buy into the process, because we didn't do that process and he didn't force it, or she didn't force it to go down the line. Well, we've got enough anxiety over what's out there that people don't understand it, don't like it, or whatever, and we really need to get that fair market price or analysis done, and we're doing that as best we can at this point in time, and figuring out how to make that policy work. And part of that's going to be taken up in two or three venues this year, and hopefully from that it will yield a better product.
Okay.
But
if I may jump in here, in late January, shortly after I started doing this job, I proceeded forward with the plans that have been set up by Casey prior to work with the Collins Center for Municipal Management to actually do a salary study, to basically review the classification chart, and to basically find out, are we paying people on that chart according to, are our salary ranges in line with what other towns are doing? After about 2.5 to 3 months, we haven't received the information that we expect from there. And so I'm speaking with another consultant this Friday, and based on the results of that, and based on the estimate that the work may cost him, I may actually be asking him to do that work if it can be done in a timely manner.
These are the studies that were commission funded at last year's town meeting?
Correct. This is out of that $10,000 appropriation.
Right.
The first one with the Collins Center was only $4,500, but it turns out it's nothing more than a glorified mail survey, which they've seen poor responses, and they actually came back to our staff and said, hey, can you guys do the rest of this for us? And
Have we paid?
Haven't paid a dime for that yet, and whether or not we're going to pay a dime is going to be another story.
Right.
But that's also going to feed into the conversation on Friday. That being said, we've also been approached by Joe Markarian from the COG, who through the Community Compact Program, that because we identify financial policies as one of our goals, one of our agreements, the Council of Governments is managing the outlay of money from the state level, and they are ready to start working with us to start developing financial policies regarding free cash, regarding stabilization, regarding OPEB, and I believe regarding employment policies. I think we can wind that in because they are integrally tied to the cost of doing business. And so while that scope isn't yet established, my hope is that starting on 1 July, we can start working to develop those policies. And I'm really hoping that we can do that as a multi-person but not single committee or board effort.
So the COG would be sort of a consultant to your office on these different things?
COG would be a facilitator for a committee consisting of probably a couple of employees. I would want to have the accountant involved. I would want to be involved. But primarily, members or representatives from town boards. I would expect that somebody from the CIPC would be involved, from the finance committee would be involved, a member of the board of selectmen would be involved, somebody from the schools down the line, to really talk about the longer term financial goals of the town, 10, 20 years out.
They would facilitate us doing the work.
Right. It won't be someone saying, do this, do that. It will be, what
Never
do you guys
want to
do?
Way.
How do we codify
well, we've failed at
place?
This twice.
Yeah.
We've put it together. We came up with a great idea, and it was had great promise, but we could never force it to. I mean, the number of reviews that I did that never went anywhere, because I can't do something as a single person. I'm a board of three, and it has to require us to agree on something that happened, and basically it gets really ugly really fast. And the fact that the people that were out there didn't buy into it. The biggest benefit from a program like this would be to have our own people understand what they need to do their job, and whether they're doing it right or wrong, because then they'll fix it. If they're waiting for somebody to tell them or look over their shoulder that they're doing something right or wrong, it doesn't work. They have to be invested in this process. So what Doug is saying is to have them invested, have somebody on that side of the table looking at it saying, yeah, we thought that was a really good reason for this reason, that reason, and basically get buy-in. And once you get buy-in, I think that it will move a lot quicker and a lot easier.
The idea is to be sustainable. It's just been really hard to do these budgets. I mean, they're tremendously stressful because there's just not enough money to do everything that we should be doing. So the whole idea of having this work through the COG is to help us develop some sustainable practices and have more discussion so people understand that, you know, we have to do this stuff, you know, in a certain way so that we can pay our bills and not get out of control. Okay. And, you know, I feel it's important that we work through the COG because, you know, they are getting paid by the state to do this. But they can come in here and be a little bit more arm's length. So you can have discussions because some of the stuff, especially if we have town employees or, you know, people have certain turfs that, you know, they want to protect and, you know, everything should be on the table.
Right.
So, you know, I really, Charlie Baker is really into this compact. I feel like he's going to stick around. He's going to be a good governor, and hopefully he'll be at least a two-termer. You know, Mitt Romney had the Commonwealth Capitol that was just a sham, and, you know, we had to jump through a lot of hoops. And we did, and it worked out to our benefit. You know, I don't know if anyone remembers that, but we did it. But this is more, I feel like more committing to this because, number one, we need it, and it's important to us. But I feel like this is going to be important to working with the governor and getting money from, you know, for programs and stuff. We have to do this. And he's very serious about it. We had his housing and development secretary last week talked to us and at the Selectmen's Association, and you know, Jay Ash was very, very straightforward. If you know, you need to be doing this stuff, and so I mean, I feel like this is more long-term commitment from the governor's office, and if we're going to get money through the state for any programs, we've got to do some of these, jump some of these hoops. But this is one that we need as a town to do anyway. So, you know, let's get together. Let's talk about it when we're not pressured, you know, by the budget process, and say, okay, you know, this is how we got to think of these things, and try to be a little bit more sustainable and stretch our dollar, you know, be more efficient with our dollars.
I think Mark is right on the bat or on the ball here, with regard to employees. I mean, we want good employees, but certainly a job should be reimbursed for its value. And you certainly can have an employee in a specific job that can do it for years very well with no problem, but they're not going to necessarily take a to a higher level. And maybe that's okay. But it but you have to reimburse for that, or otherwise you are pulling money out of the residents needlessly. And it does start with exactly what Doug is saying. You've got to have job descriptions. They've got to be accurate. And you've got to understand your financial steps and what they are. But the hardest thing in the world is to get these managers to understand they have to, if it's annually, go through the process and grade these people, and then sit down with that young lady or man, and who might be a next-door neighbor, and say, look, you know, you're marginally doing your job. You're just, you know, and that's a tough thing. You're just, but without the structure, without the whole team behind them, behind that manager,
it makes
it difficult to make it happen.
It makes it very, almost impossible, because you're asking them to carry the weight of everything and not basically be supported by the human resources and the things that need to be in place.
Exactly.
But so, it's also really important to empower our employees to look at the job that they're doing and say, how can they do it better? How can they be more efficient? How do we
really,
we take less resources and do more?
That's what it's all about. I mean,
and so you know, you want to have a system that has incentives so they can think. And the person that I think of right off the top of my head is Chuck at the highway garage. You know, I mean, he is always looking at ways to save money, do more stuff, fix stuff, make have a longer lifespan, whatever. I mean, that's somebody that is a huge value to us because he's constantly trying to think about
stuff. I didn't
stuff.
Mean to beat everybody down into the lowest I just meant that
right.
If they understand this is where they're going to stay unless they change and contribute, that's...
Well, I think you need to establish process because that has a ripple effect through all the committees, too. And once you have consistency and it's laid out so everybody can see how it should work, when, you know, like with Doug, if he comes to the finance committee and is asking for a recommendation, at least we have something to look at. And right now, we really don't. So it's difficult. I think it puts, you know, people on the spot trying to make decisions when we have a little bit of a moving target. You know, we understand to an extent what the real goal is, like Mark explained. But if we don't have that process fixed in place, then it makes it very difficult to make recommendations on, you know, obviously budget items and personnel.
Well, personnel has, you know, we're working to having a very active functional personnel process, and that should be its own reward in where we go. It should be that basically you guys shouldn't have to be worrying about what personnel's doing or how they're doing it.
Agreed.
Basically, it should be on the personnel committee along with the department heads to actually make it clear what's happening, so it shouldn't be a questionable thought process. And we're in a dilemma now because basically there's that catch-up period of time in which we're going to have to make things work,
right.
And that's what we're doing right now.
If I could just ask for one thing of clarification, because I still, there's one thing I'm not clear on, and I've been asked this question a couple of times. And again, it's really just for the Step 10 Plus. How did, if I understand what you said earlier, for Step 10 Plus, for the COLAs, it was set by each individual department head?
It was, no. There is, take COLA out of your vocabulary, because in our aspect, somebody may have used the word COLA in the process. But it is basically a net worth of a person above the Step 10 requirement.
Right. Whatever term you want to use for that,
yeah.
Which has been set at 1.7% this year, how did that get set? That's my question.
Who set the 1.7?
Right.
Yeah. We just.
It was inherited from the previous year.
Okay.
And how was it set in the previous year?
That I couldn't tell you. I don't know.
It was just a number?
Was it a pure number? No, I believe it was determined based on a recommendation from the personnel committee to the Board of Selectmen.
It was.
So we didn't ask for another one this year?
We can ask for...
We haven't asked for one this year yet, no.
Okay, because that's where I've been asked a couple of times of where does that come from and how did they set it?
In the past, they would look at all the indexes.
Right.
And they would come up with it. But
we have two formulas.
I can't remember how they came up with the 1.7 from the year before.
I'd have to get someone from personnel.
Well, that's why I'm getting the question.
We just use the same.
Social Security was zero last year.
And that's the questions I get. If Social Security is zero, why isn't this zero? And I don't think it should be zero. I think there should be some range where the low isn't zero and the high isn't the highest it could be that the town kind of goes around. But that's not for me to decide. Like I said, I don't know who it is.
What we did in past years, and I don't know what was done in you know.
Can't remember, actually.
Well, I can tell you that basically we used two of the indexes. We averaged them, add them together, and took a medium number.
Okay.
And basically it was the New England, because we're in the New England cost of living formula there, and then the national. Okay. And we put them together and then divided by two, and we had a number that fat in the middle of it. It took us forever to get that number produced, and that's why we went to what we're in right now, because everybody had an opinion on it. It was not...
We weren't using Social Security. We were using that New England one Mark was talking about, I think is because it had the oil, you know, heating oil index in it.
Yeah.
And there was one other thing.
The national average for cost of living increase. You put the two of them in.
But the New England
took a little bit off of the top, and basically it was a formula. Whether they used that last year or not, according to Doug, they just used the same number over again and put it on the table. We can crunch the numbers and you can make a recommendation as to what it is.
I don't have a recommendation. I don't even have an opinion other than if that's the way we're supposed to do it, then, you know, I'd love to just say, okay, here's number one, number two, here's the average, this is it. Maybe we round it, but this is it. And if that's not our process, I just would like to see it articulated. Well, wherever the number comes out, unless it comes out at, you know, negative 10 or 20, I'm going to support it because that's the process. Mm-hmm. I don't think I'm smarter than the process. I just don't know what the process had been.
Okay.
So
I just can't remember exactly what the combination was
for
last year.
I'll look into it.
What's that?
We'll look into it and come up with the...
Great. Thank you. That'd be great.
Thank you.
It used to be set up by the COLA, where, as Mark said, the urban wage earners cost index, which comes out of Boston, and that's how we used to do it. And one year we turned around and did it with that and the national average. And the bottom line is that the responsibility for determining that is a personnel committee. So let them just do their job.
That's great.
Tell us what it is. And if they don't tell us what it is, then I think it's up to the selectmen to determine what it should be and just say, this is what we're going to allow, 1%, 3%, whatever.
Right. Well, I'll look into it and see where I'll look at the numbers. We'll get Doug to do a little thing and see how where we're at in the process, and we'll chase it from there.
Perfect.
I remember Bernie used to turn around and say, time to look at the cost of living adjustment, because the quarter ended on 30 September, and all of a sudden he wanted to know what it was so he could turn around and plan for his pay raise.
Well, I just remember we used to try to do the combination because we felt the combination was a better.
I think it probably is.
Moderating effect
right.
from having the higher one in Boston.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, just because of the heating oil like this year, next year's heating oil is not going to be that big of a deal on the process. And if you go to Louisiana at this point in time, the cost of living or cost of the COLA is much higher than it is right here.
Sure.
So across the board, they'll give a national average, and it may temper it down by what the Northeast is. So it's a fair way of actually putting it in place. But the reality is, if we keep the system working the way it should be, an employee should stay in the medium range of what that job pays. It should be adjusted so that basically nobody gets to step 10, because the way it was originally designed was that at 7, it would be readjusted and a person would fall in the range back, and then you would keep going so that... But if somebody got to 10, it was all merit then. It was all on how they did in their job and could be justified by their department head to determine whether or not. But as I said, the system is broken at this point in time, and we need something, because the employees we have that are at step 10 are deserving of to look at what they're really worth, and they deserve not to be left out or left behind at this point in time.
And I agree with you, to the extent that larger system is updated / overhauled, then this becomes much less, if not a non-issue, this particular thing.
We hope.
Yeah, we hope.
Yes.
So, the next one I'd love to bring up is CPA. We had just talked about, this is maybe a month ago, and kind of one of our big picture moments, if the budget's going to be tough and we're having trouble and, you know, there's additional debt from the school or other things, should we revisit the CPA tax? We understand there's a matching component, so we get that. But with a fairly sizable amount there and maybe there's plans, I'm not aware, I don't know of big picture plans for that money or projects that are kind of coming down the horizon. Is that something we should consider reducing just to try to lower the tax burden, given that we're going to have increases in, you know, general taxation and school roofs and things like that?
I guess my personal feeling is that as long as we're getting the maximum match, I have no problem just dropping it off if we don't get the match, because just putting money aside randomly is not a good thing. But we are getting the state match. Mm-hmm. And so I can't think of a better way, since we aren't investing in capital stuff ourselves, is to set this money aside for capital things. And we do have the senior center over here that is eligible for you know, historical renovation monies. And that's multi, you know, several hundred thousand dollars.
What about some of the smaller senior center projects, like the ones in the capital budget this year? Are those things that are eligible or
not? Well,
most of those are not, actually. I inquired about that. Smaller operational expenses or program expenses cannot be funded through the CPA, through the monies that are set aside through the CPA. And the ability to use that money for capital improvements has to meet certain criteria, not the least of which is historic preservation. It's not the fact that it's a community center, or that it's for the senior center, or even that it's a multi-town, you know, used building. It's the fact that it's a historic preservation that you're trying to do. They don't care about what you're doing inside the walls. You know, the money would only be able to renovate the building.
So that
so there's limitations there.
Yeah, but that would qualify when we go to renovate that building, because we have to do something with that building. The other thing is, you know, senior housing. At some point, we want to do senior housing, and that again is, you know, multi-million dollars. So it seems like we're building up this fund, but no matter what we want to do with it, we have, you know, just huge chunks of change that have to come out of there. And open space, conservation restrictions kind of stuff that, you know, if we have to come up with a match, that's, you know, sometimes that's a lot of money. We haven't had anything in the last couple of years, 3 or 4 years, that I can think of offhand.
Because there's no money for APR.
No, there still is money. It's come through the federal government. The farmland, the state hasn't put any money aside itself, but the federal government has still, money is still coming through that they funnel in. But there just hasn't been any projects that we're required to match for. And that has gotten to the point where, you know, we couldn't do it in our operational budget because our operational budget was so tight. So that was another reason to do the CPA. So I know the CPA money feels like it's not doing anything. We're just collecting that money. But we have, you know, fully intending to do something with the senior center, fully intentions to do senior housing at some point. And like I said, if there was a open space kind of thing, we would probably want, the town in the past has always supported that kind of stuff. So I hate to cut that, because even though you're paying taxes, it's, you're investing in the town and you're getting a dollar for dollar match from the state. So
it's 50%, it's 100% still?
What happens is there's three, if you have the 3%, which we do, there's three phases of the CPA match. And it has been through Steve Kulik. What happened there for a little while, there was several times when the money was getting really close where they weren't going to be able to match. So Steve Kulik has, through his work, got, I don't know, some funding source. I forget, through the registry. It's another funding source that's just purely dedicated to it. So it's not, never falls short. So it's a really good deal as long as we're getting the match. Mm.
Those are the three categories, or there are other categories?
It's unrestricted, but there's housing, mm-hmm, and historic preservation.
And open space.
Open space,
yeah.
Those three.
There's also a senior component. There's four components, right?
Well, that would be, the senior, senior or
the housing.
Housing, right. It's either a senior assisted living housing.
You can do
other things with it, because they've used it for many different things. Our biggest issue right now is that we really need to keep, along your lines, get a game plan as to where the money's got to go.
Right.
And what is it there for? Because right now, the more people that know that it exists, the more people that will attempt to raid it.
Well, that's the concern is...
Hard to say no is...
Right. But that's my concern is that, and you guys are addressing it, so thank you. The concern is it so restrictive that, like, the OPEB conversation, you're going to put money away and then be out of money later? Doesn't seem that way. Is it so flexible that you worry about what projects might come through just because the money's sitting there? And that's where I think that, you know, the process set up seems to have been working well so far, but, you know, as it was building, as we looked at this year's budget, that's why we thought it was warranted to just kind of revisit.
Well, you can do it for acquisition too, and, you know, there is some possibilities that we could add on to the, you know, next door to the senior center and stuff like that, that through property there.
There's a lot of things.
There's a lot of stuff that...
That has happened, and basically, yeah. You know, like, I think it's vitally important that we have a plan to what we're going to be using the money for, because if not, more people are finding different ways of utilizing the funds. And don't get me wrong, a lot of them have been very good projects for the town, but I think that it's more important that we address some of these issues that we've had outstanding for quite a while and not done anything to address them.
Is there anything? I'm sorry, go ahead.
The reason I brought that up was because, I'll give you an example. Our beginning balance was $1.86 million. We've added revenue of $247,000, almost a quarter of a million. We've expended $194,000. So we still went up $52,000, and our balance as of the end of March was $1.914 million. That's a lot more than our stabilization account. All I'm saying is if we've got it, if you've got a plan to use it, that's fine. But if we're not going to use it, and we're going to leave an almost $2 million sitting there.
Well, John, as you know, to do anything in
$2 million didn't cover the roof.
Sometimes people don't understand that you got $1.9 million there.
I know, but if we build senior housing, we're only probably 20% there.
We're not even 20%. It costs us, you know, you're talking about a building that's probably going to, buildings that are probably going to take up the space of the roof, I mean of the school. For us to get the school's roof done was $3 million. $2 million to get a project like that off the ground is going to be a great seed.
Well, it's an important question because of what you just said. If the public town or municipal or state or whatever government is the best person to be building things like that, I understand the town may want to incentivize that sort of development, and I think that makes sense. But, you know, to lead into very expensive projects, that's where it gets a little tricky for me. Is that the best way to accomplish that?
Well, if you're talking about renovating the senior center.
That's different. Yeah. We're talking about, right.
But if
right.
you're talking about building, I would look at that as a seed for senior housing to partner with a private person.
Okay.
And
Or whatever, you know.
I understand there's options
that
we don't.
There's options, and the thing is, we as, once we get to a point of getting past all these other issues, we need to find towns that have whipped this problem and just model it. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. I mean, we built, just before I started, we had senior housing built in the town, a project to build it here. In the last minute, we chickened out. We got cold feet, and they took the plans, and they took our name off of it, and you can still find our name on those plans if you go up to Montague.
To Gill.
Gill, they used the
through Montague to Gill. They just took our plans and they built it there. And it's beautiful. They're really functional. It really was a great project. But we didn't
jump on
through
it when the federal government offered it to us. The selectmen at the time refused it. So they just turned around and changed Deerfield to Gill, gave it to Gill, and they built them. And I know somebody who lives in one of them, and they're very happy with them.
So, I mean,
well, and
we
and
have
the
to
time
be
before that, it was Montague
cognizant.
And Berniston. Northfield and Berniston that split Deerfield's units in another application.
Right.
They chickened out and or crossed out the name Deerfield and split the units.
Maybe we should hire out to other
I know. But the problem is there's no more funding for senior stuff. And seniors in our community, I mean, demographically, we are having a higher and higher proportion of older citizens, and we're not doing much for them. And
Carolyn, you're wrong. We're not getting older. Our kids are.
Oh, well, what I'm saying is
that I feel
that
much better about it.
I just remember the first senior housing committee that I was on. It was in 1998, and so we're getting on a while. And so I know it seems like a lot of money, Dylan, but there is a real use for it, and we have to figure out how to go about it. But I would say from my personal desire is to do something for the seniors, and we definitely need to do something for the senior center. Mm-hmm. We have to renovate that, and I would like to do some kind of housing. And there's been a few people that we've talked to and in the past that we might partner with, and there's several nonprofits that we could probably partner with at some point.
Who drives this process of coming up with an idea and approving it? And is it
well,
board,
we did have a very active committee, mm-hmm. and but it would just
they all get old.
Literally, people. I mean, it is really sad. People literally died.
The town has to drive it.
Yeah.
We have
to answer
drive
your question.
It.
The town has to drive it. We have to find people in town that are willing to, and usually it's, you know, a bunch of people who have parents that they want to look out for, or but you have to have an incentive or a thought process.
And the idea goes out,
and then does it go to town meeting, or
it would have to go to town meeting.
Oh, it would go to town meeting.
That's what I meant.
Absolutely.
But the thing is that, you know, we've really been lackluster about saying out loud that mm-hmm. we need to deal with the senior issues. Some of the issues that have come up, you know, from the historical point have been great, but they're things that, you know, somebody's championing it because they really are interested in that. So the thing is, we need to get people excited and figure out where we're going to go, or we've got some pretty good staff now that we're going to be looking for examples of things that work, rather than having to invent the wheel from the beginning. Let's see if there's something out there that we can tag on to that mm-hmm. that works in the long run and get some of the nuts and bolts down solid.
We tried for years to work through the Franklin Regional Housing.
Would it be time to invite them back here and ask them for a current update of what the status is, and ask them for a ballpark figure what it'll cost to get things going, see if we got enough to start it?
Now you're back to government building.
One of the problems is it.
Now you're coming back to government doing work that maybe the private sector might be better suited to.
But the thing is, we voted before to make the Franklin Regional Housing Authority our housing authority for the town of Deerfield. So what I'm saying is it time to bring them back and ask them, because they're the people who should be doing it?
Well, I have to say,
if they can't do it or funding's not available, then the question is, what other options are available?
Right. We should get them to report back to us that there is no funding available, or if there is funding available, because really what happened is that the money just dried up. I mean, overnight.
Or if they have ideas for us to go some other route. But yes, I think it's very appropriate for us to invite them back, and not to interrogate them, but to ask them,
what's the current
situation? Where do we go from here?
Yeah.
Where can we go from here?
That's right.
Part of it is to get the current situation and what's the update, what's happening, you know, in government programs that we might be eligible for or something like that.
The board is the one that would invite them to.
Yes.
We will, yes.
Yeah.
The sad part, or whoever's sitting here will, I honestly believed at this point in time when our population, and I say ours because I'm right there at that cusp of senior citizens, carry enough votes that they would start seeing that if they don't speak up, nothing's going to be done for them. I haven't seen that revolution at this point in time. Mm-hmm. We're too busy arguing about who's the best person to do nothing in Congress right now. So I think it's great that you reminded us that we need to go back and ask those questions.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. The next issue is one that's, I guess, related to a particular budget, but is the school resource officer. Mm-hmm. And the reason I want to bring this up, and again, I guess I'll speak for myself here, anyone else can chime in on the finance committee. To me, a school resource officer being presented to be a collaborative position between the schools and the police, and what's been presented in the budget is really more just an additional police officer with having responsibilities towards the schools, as we've been doing over the past year. And I guess that's where it's hard for me, because my reticence isn't so much about wanting it or not wanting it, but if I don't see the schools coming forth, and I know there's been some conversation as to whether it's how much they feel they need it or how it would actually work, or maybe just how late it was in the budget process. I'll let other people speak for themselves as to which of those or a combination of those it was, but some one of those or a combination seems to be enough that it was not prioritized and put into their budget. And so that's where it gets tougher for me, because the request is really different than what the numbers are. And so that's why I wanted to bring it up and to see, because I know you guys have been kind of dealing with this as well and figuring out where funding was going to come from and how we were going to do it. So that's why I wanted to bring that one up.
Can I just ask you guys a question?
Sure.
In your researching of this subject, have you got the history of where it's gone and why it is where it is today?
The particular to the town of Deerfield and the position,
yes,
we're talking about?
Yeah, just because it's only about that position we're,
right,
talking about. I don't care about any other town in aspect,
right.
Right. But the reality is we're at a point with, you know, asking for funding for a resource officer or not. I mean, that's the bottom line. You're talking about whether or not you're going to fund it or not fund it at the town level. This is what is on our table, because we went out and tried to shame the school into doing the right thing in accordance with Mass General Law. And
because it is mandatory, actually.
Well, the town, in combination with between the school and the police department, can opt out. It's not mandated because it wasn't funded.
But to say that the only way you can opt out of it is to say that it's not needed.
Right.
You
and
have
I
to sign off.
And I understand
and
that's
no way that our chief would do that.
Well, I understand that's an extremely unfair thing that the state did to every town in the state. I mean, yeah, that is the single biggest problem with the situation, full stop, like right from the beginning. So I get that. And that's where we're all trying to figure out what the best solution from there is. And I understand that there's a lot of good things that are going on between the two groups, between the police and the school, and I think that everybody does want to work together. My concern is if we're shaming the school into it and they don't seem to be behind it, is that going to be the type of successful collaborative situation that we want this to be? That's my concern.
The principal of the high school, Frontier, wrote a wonderful letter to our chief about the success of our officer and their police department working within the schools just recently. And I understand the officer and the police were in the elementary school to handle a bullying situation very successfully. So I think it's been extremely successful and that the principals are totally behind it. And I think there's a disconnect between the school committees that have to okay the budget and the need versus what is actually happening in the schools.
Again, the request for money from the schools came after their budgets were completed.
Yeah.
Like, in all fairness, that's a factual statement. We didn't ask them, and my statement of shaming them was trying to get them to reopen the thought process to do it, not that they didn't think that it was really necessary. It was the fact that it wasn't timely.
But we talked about this a full year ago, right?
And we thought the place to do it was there.
So that's what's hard for me is I don't understand. I understand now that there's an 11th hour issue, but we had 365 days.
Yeah. There are two things that contributed to that from our board, and you guys correct me if I'm wrong, is the fact that we thought there would be other monies available to cover that need. I personally didn't agree with that philosophy, but that's what we kind of hinged our thought process is that there would be another pay-in to the process. That's why we started that fund, and we thought that it wouldn't have to go to the schools. It would be funded from town-sponsored monies.
What Mark's referring to is the dispensary, marijuana
right.
dispensary.
Right, and I get that.
So
and
I think we fell.
Thought that was
we
gonna
fell,
be online.
We fell off our horse, and we didn't do what we should have done, champion from the beginning, thinking that it was going to take care of itself and leaving it in the background. Bad? Are we bad? Yeah, we're bad. We didn't cover all bases, but I think that there's not one of us here that thought that we'd be at this crossroads. We thought that this would have been something that was taken care of in the budgets, either in contributed money or from the schools coming to it. So I really didn't see this one coming. This one got me by surprise.
I think you kind of hit the nail on the head, though. It's we would want to feel assured that both groups buy in, because that's the only way it really works, is if everybody's behind it. Right. It certainly sounds like they are, but then there's a certain shying away from it when it comes to the funding. Well, and ultimately the town's going to pay anyway, but I think you're saying it correctly.
Well, that's what's tough, and this is something, and this is a very important issue, and I do very much value the work that can be done, has been done, and will be done, whether it's through a dedicated officer or just the police force in their aid of the community and the schools as well. But there's a number of things in this year's budget where some service or thing was done in one year, and then the next year it's added to the budget. And the taxpayer just kind of has to be told, well, we're already doing this, so it can't not be done anymore, so now you got to pay for it. And I think that's just really difficult for the taxpayers, and I understand there's a particular story to this one as to how we got there related to the dispensary, but there's a number of these, and again for me personally, I've been pretty categorically against all the instances or almost all the instances where this has been happening, and I really think it's a problem with the way that we budget, not specific to the police department or this thing, but that's a mindset that we really have to get away from of mm-hmm. let's start doing it, we think we'll figure it out. Sometimes we do and it works out, and then when we don't, we just send the bill. Like, that's, as a taxpayer, that's where we're having, or at least I'm having a tough time as a finance committee member on these types of situations.
I think that it's a valuable point to be at, and I don't disagree with the facts that as you've laid them out, and you're spot on, but it doesn't change where we are, and whatever you guys come up with a recommendation, at this point in time, the Board of Selectmen will take it under advisement. But I mean, unless there's another avenue, I think we just.
Yeah, no, we're not trying to get you to change your recommendation or us to vote this tonight. No. Talking about kind of the way we got here is the valuable part of this conversation, at least for me, and I think for all of us.
And we agree wholeheartedly. And I think that by bringing talent to the boards, hopefully in the election coming up and your own boards, that we can work cooperatively to make those things, mitigate those and make them go away. I'm not disagreeing with this. All I'm saying is I got this in my plate for consideration, and it's a no go, and everybody hates me when I say that. It's for me, it's you don't fund it or you fund it. I mean, you can't, it's already got a half a fund. You can't do that to the mix of what we have in front of us right now. So I'm totally agreed that we need good financial policies to make sure that we don't just arbitrarily stick something in there that see if it works, other than when we present it that way. There are things we've come to the table and said, we really don't know how this is going to work, but it's something we need to fix. We want to try this. As long as we say that up front and know that next year it can go away. And trust me, from my feeling right now, if I don't have buy-in next year from the schools, if we give it that second year, I'm going to have a different point of view. I'm going to be looking at, why are we funding this if the schools don't want to put it in place?
It's a one-way ratchet. You're not going to be going back the other way.
Sure.
I mean, I've observed this in other towns and states
not
across the country.
If I'm here, I can tell you right now that if they don't cough up the money, because reality, and the argument that I have we haven't talked about is the fact that we provided to Frontier in a big chunk of his time. That's where the biggest conglomerate of time is. That's sponsoring three other towns.
Yeah.
we're paying for the other towns to have safety and security in there. And don't get me wrong, it's worth it for our kids in that town. But it's not fair that I ask the taxpayers to carry that load on top of it. Exactly. So my recommendation is we give it one more year, and I'll stand up in town meeting if I'm not here, if I'm not in the Board of Selectmen, and say, I don't think it's appropriate for the town of Deerfield to carry all this weight. And so but I don't think we can change anything. I think we've done all we can do logistically to change what can happen for this year. I think that, I honestly think calmer heads will prevail, and basically it will work out after another year.
Okay.
So why doesn't the town just build a school district?
It's a thought. It's a little late now because it's not in their budget. Pardon?
And therefore it won't be paid.
Yeah. So we can't appropriate it. We can't add it to their budget for them at this point because we can't put any more money in their budget.
And
yeah. Well, no, that's what I'm talking about. I think we will get on this earlier and not be as, again, it's a startup program. We learn from our mistakes and hopefully don't repeat them, because then, you know, we're not doing a good job.
So would it make sense after town meeting, whatever the outcome here, that we send a letter to all the schools involved and say, you know, we need clarification from you folks because Marty's not going to be here.
Right. Well, what we need to do is send a letter to our elected officials, which are the school committees,
yeah,
and tell them that this is how we feel about it. And that we think that basically they should consider putting it in the budgets and not stop at that. But again, it's stuff we didn't think of.
Honestly, if I may, I want to follow up on John Pereski's suggestion. As we were building our budgets over the course of the fall, we received notices from the FRCOG, from the Franklin County Solid Waste District, and a number of other regional entities saying, hey, we know you're in the budget planning process, looking forward, here's what you can expect to pay, here's our best estimate. Vroom, there it is. So there's no reason why, absolutely,
yeah,
following up, we
saying.
Start talking with the school administration 1 July. But in October, November, we send them a letter saying, hey, in order to help us continue to fund the school resource officer, you can expect a bill as of 1 July for this amount of money to help offset the cost of the school resource officer. And if we send that out as a pre-notice,
right,
in November, then there's, they have something they can include in their budgetary.
And there's no excuses for consideration. And as I said, if they don't want it, you're 100% spot on. If they really don't want it, you can't force it on. They're not going to use them to their best advantages.
At the public presentation of the grammar school budget, and again at the Frontier budget, the school stated that if they were given the choice in a constrained budget of cutting teachers or hours or whatever, or not doing this, they weren't doing this.
Correct.
That's what they said.
Yeah.
So isn't that the answer you're waiting to get next year?
No, because it's going to be a different budget analysis. I don't believe that's going to happen.
Would that be your input to Doug tonight to send that letter out then?
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll put it part of our budget.
Mm-hmm. So Doug will be doing that, right?
Sure.
You would, okay.
Absolutely.
I didn't know if you were hearing me or...
What am I doing? By the way?
Sending the letter.
What aren't you doing?
In
you're
October,
billing
absolutely.
In October, you're billing them.
Yeah. But I do know that, and I've had conversations with the chief that as of 1 July, to begin with, I want to reach out to the new superintendent and establish a solid working relationship. But we are going to talk about, between the chief and myself and the superintendent, we're going to talk about the school resource officer and how that position can be best used at all of the schools in the district, but also primarily at Frontier Regional. And by doing so, the establishing the value of that to the schools, and therefore when they get the bill in October or November, it's going to be like, oh, of course, that's, yeah.
I just want to make sure that we are actually getting credit for what we have been doing, because, you know, your foundation budget, you know, what you contribute. We always provide the police for Frontier.
Right.
The police response, fire department response, stuff like that. So, Doug, you have to make sure that this is built into that information, because this is new information. That should be updated, by the way, since we have been providing. So they, you know, give, you're supposed to say what you contribute as a community, and that would be what we're contributing.
So following up on that, if we need to include what we're contributing as a community, or what the town is contributing, if those costs help to build into our foundation budget, isn't the expectation that the insurance costs related for the elementary school should also be included in that calculation? That's something I'm going to need to follow up on then.
Yep.
Because I'm not sure. I don't know if they have been. Maybe they are, but I'd like to find out.
I'd say they probably are not.
Because that's a $500,000 to $600,000 at least expense.
We've always had it as a basically a fisticuff fight. It's never been, hey, this is what it is. And you know, it's not.
Well, since
it's
we've
not
been breaking it out, we've been breaking
it out, and it's real. It's not something that you cost X, Y, or Z without any facts or any thought. It's become a very methodical system in which we're trying to make
Doug,
sure
you know what I'm talking about.
Everybody understands
contribution, community contribution.
I can work with. I do know what you're talking about, and okay. I'm going to need to work with Patty Cavanaugh to determine how that's reported.
Well, we just want to make sure it's reported.
Yeah.
You might be. Better to reach out to
Department of Ed,
Northfield, or somebody who has a regional school in their district to see how they write their.
Sure. Okay.
Because they just added their resource officer up there. But you'd want to add
the
whole value.
But I mean, in the big picture,
you'd want to add the whole value.
The resource officer, and honestly, the administrative and direct cost, and so on and so forth.
Even though we have some of it offset with a donation, you include the whole thing.
Absolutely.
Because it's a in-town donation.
I thought about it as everyone went.
But I'm way off the track. Sorry.
No.
Sorry, Dylan, but it just made me think about that.
I guess we kind of shared.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to make sure this was a new thing that wouldn't have. You know, nobody would have passed it in. And we're picking up the whole cost. So that should go to our profile and not be missed.
I guess staying, and I think this will be a quick one because, again, it's really just high level, but the Frontier budget. Obviously, it's a fairly large increase this year. And, this isn't one where it's, okay, change this line item or that line item and you kind of get to where you can hand, it's, you're really just looking at a very big number and contemplating if it needs to be that or a slightly less really big number. As you guys kind of went through your process, or how do you, obviously this is one that's a little bit different than the town departments themselves. How do we think about where this is going and how the town can handle these increases?
Well, I don't know what the, I'll admit up front, I don't know what the bottom line numbers are. But in the past years, we've looked at it the same way we have the town, in saying that basic proposition 2.5 applies to it. The problem we have is with the foundation, with the formula, we can get hit with a bill higher than 2.5% if their budget stays at 2.5%. So in the past, we've asked for them, and we've successfully had them. And the elementary school does that on a regular basis if you look across the board. I think we need to make it stronger plea and statement to them that basically it's not sustainable for them to do this. And I would actually look at, since a lot of it is operational policy issues as to how they got to where they are, that we look at more than 1 year to say, okay, maybe you were a little bit low this time, or maybe but try to get a five-year average and actually have that conversation with them that says, hey, we can't do it. Why do you think it's appropriate for you to do it, especially with the fact that you're not servicing as many people as you were before?
Did we get the updated Chapter 70 numbers on this, Doug?
We did.
Okay, so what's the actual increase with the new Chapter 70 numbers plugged in?
Oh, I'm sorry, Chapter 70. Let me pull up the budget.
For the full budget? Or are you talking about school?
No, Dylan was referring to the Frontier Regional increase.
I honestly do not have the updated chapters. At least I don't think I do. Let me.
Because usually when they put in the Chapter 70, it adjusts it one way or the other a little bit. And I think the numbers went up a little bit than our original estimate.
The Chapter 70 number that I have for FY17 is 2,784,275.
Oh, that is in here.
Which is about a $14,000 increase. I am not 100% accurate that that is the most up-to-date number, but I'm fairly certain it is.
So that is
so
dated.
And I understand this is one we're going to have to recommend or not recommend, and we're going to go to town and probably have a, you know, not short conversation about this, but, you know, it's just, and I understand the school's perspective. This isn't, you know, there's a lot of cost increases that they're having to bear and that we're having to bear both with their budgets and on our own as well. And as you said, everybody's kind of facing this, and it's becoming increasingly difficult.
It's not sustainable.
Yeah, it's not sustainable, and it's not specific to Frontier, and it's not specific to this area. And you know, that's where I just, that's where you kind of want to take a step back and say, okay, where are we headed with this? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think my concern is that, you know, kind of an easy thing that gets talked about in times like this with schooling is, okay, well, you've got the regional high school, then you look to regionalized grammar schools, and that has a whole bunch of non-budget issues to sort out. But even on the budget side, there's an additional concern of, is that going to fix any problems or just be a temporary stopgap, and then you're back in the same boat 5 to 10 years down the road?
We've been sponsoring and trying to advocate for us to look progressively at our schools. Mm-hmm. And if we regionalized, or even if we came up with an MOU that talked about having four schools become three and have some sort of math, sciences, arts program that's equivalent to what a charter school may do, but have it an internal charter school where we can actually take in either students or take our students that exist now and move them into an environment that lets them excel, which would mean more of our kids would stay here. So it's a progressive look at where are we going from here? And those are just some of the ideas that have been bantered around. It's not; those are not my recommendations. Those are things that people are talking about doing. And we're sponsoring that. We're sponsoring. It's no different than working with our other districts. We're looking for how do we make you better and more sustainable? Because then we all win. And we're not looking for cuts. We're not looking to take something away from somebody. We're looking for how do we get better? And that means doing a better job and have more real value added to the townspeople. And then they may not mind if it costs more, but at least they're showing where it's just not a repetitive increase in budgets. So we're sponsoring it, and Carolyn's been a champion of a lot of those type of meetings and been to a lot of those meetings. Dave, when he was here, was thoroughly involved, and I'm hoping that basically we can keep that up. And I think that it's on the precipice of having some people actually start thinking. This elementary school's been phenomenal. They've actually, I hope I'm correct in this statement, but I think they've actually dropped their second classroom off at the beginning, which is going to show the town a big savings. It costs the elementary school a huge amount of money to do that because both those classes was revenue into their pocket, not accountable for the Chapter 70 or from the town's thing. So for them to step up and do that is a huge commitment to the town's taxpayers. We just have to carry it out to the next steps and see if there's something else we can do to make it better and capitalize on what they're doing. I think we're, without getting into the realm where we're hiring people to fix our problems, I think we're doing a pretty good job in that arena of trying to get that to work. And I think we've got people thinking as teams rather than fighting for their own territories. And I have to commend the elementary school for being a team player in that aspect of it. So,
Doug, or maybe Trevor, you know, when is that report from the UMass due?
I don't know that there is a deadline to it. The last I knew, they were still doing information gathering and interviews, okay. And that was as recent as about a month ago.
Okay, so you haven't heard anything?
No.
Since?
I haven't either.
You don't know either?
No, it wouldn't hurt to ask the question. Where it's at.
On education tomorrow.
Yeah.
Stan Rosenberg's piloting an issue because Baker wants to raise the cap on charter schools. So in line with that, we're looking to get money back into the public education and change governance of charter schools. There's actually a huge bill that's going to be debated tomorrow in the Senate on education and how it affects towns and rural, especially rural.
And no, nobody's really happy. There isn't either side that's going to aim in victory with either one of those, with that.
Which means we're on the right path.
No, I think unfortunately, from what I've looked at that bill, the problem is that there's not two sides, there's three. There's the charter schools, which will be getting the increase in the cap. There's the public schools, who will be getting increasing funding. And then there's the taxpayers, who will be getting increased foundation budgets that will go back to our bottom lines. So I think two of those are looking pretty good in that budget for that bill, and the taxpayers not looking quite as hot on a standalone basis.
My understanding was that basically it's going to make people think about how they do charter schools, and that basically the charter schools had to prove worth in the process before they get to exercise the cap.
Right, and that part makes sense. So there's a lot of
from my point of view, that carrot out there to get a better quality of school at a more reasonable cost to the towns may help the towns in the bottom line, because we're paying for those kids to go to the charter school. Right. And if all they're doing is going to a very exclusive club to get a document that really isn't any, I'm going to get out there on the limb now and say, not much better than what we're giving at the elementary schools we have here, because we're well sought after. I think that it's going to ratchet the thought process towards having the taxpayer get a better end result out of the process. And again, that's just my take on all the stuff I've read and heard and listened to both sides. And the third side, I am the taxpayer, so I do realize that that's something that we're going to chase. But again, if we don't do anything, we just keep paying. If we don't make some sort of changes and we don't get something better, we pay for something that's either half broken or not half there.
I mean, we feel like we don't have much control over our school budgets already.
Right.
But we have absolutely none over the charter schools. And they charge higher rates than what the public schools, you know, budgets are. And they come off of our cherry sheets even before we get our money for school. And, you know, so to me, it's terrible because there's not oversight, there's no local control, there's nothing. And we're essentially paying for private education. And, you know, And you're undermining public schools, and I feel that's wrong. So somebody has to look at this, and Stan and Steve know our issues out here. So, I mean,
and to answer your question, we talk 2 to 3 times a year.
I mean, I just talked to Steve last week about this. You know how
this subject in the schools,
and nothing west of Worcester ever gets kind of dealt with. You know, school choice isn't a problem near Boston, so they don't really care. And the charter school dynamic is very different, and their charter school costs are much closer to their per pupil cost, I'm guessing. I don't know.
Right. No,
and so it's less of a divergence issue when you're losing or gaining.
Right.
And, you know, again, we're getting a little bit off topic, and I don't want to do that any more than anyone else, but, you know, that's the challenging part, is we've identified the issues, but it's hard to see where the steps are being taken beyond our level to help us get it back on the right track.
I think you hit the nail pretty much on the head with the fact that we're pretty much on our own, because we're the minority in the bigger picture, and they're solving the majority issues in Boston. We need to figure out how to make it work here.
But that's why I was so excited about the Long Range Planning Committee, because you were talking about looking at, like, say, Whately, who is like 50% school choice. You know, you could close Whately as an elementary school and move the kids to Sunderland or up to Deerfield or wherever, or Conway, move Conway kids down to Deerfield or whatever. And then you could make a science math academy kind of magnet school and send the kids within our district down there, you know, that. So what you could do is you could do these exciting new things or cutting edge stuff that wouldn't cost us anything more, would attract more kids, would keep our kids in district, and we would utilize our buildings better.
But trying to solve it by getting more kids and not losing more kids is sort of zero sum. Like if you right. take Western Mass as a whole, so then we make it and everyone around us goes under. Like that to me is
I agree.
That's part of it. It's sort of like building. If we build a casino and then the next guy, like if everybody builds them, then nobody's going
but,
to.
But you'd look anyway, at the but you'd look at the thing like yeah. a common sense thing, Dylan, would be you move the sixth grades, all the sixth grades over to Frontier. You sell the superintendent's building and you move the superintendent's up to Frontier because you know Frontier has less students now.
Right.
Than
and there are, we have options. You're right. There's
and
different
so,
things.
And so you could look at those things and you could say we got rid of this old building. The superintendent now is an office, you know, within the two biggest schools anyway, mm-hmm. within walking distance of the two biggest schools. And you've saved overhead and maintenance, but maybe you have some kind of, you know, real excitement now in the middle school because you have 6th, 7th, and 8th together or, you know, whatever. It's just doing something, thinking outside the box. How do we deliver education in a more exciting way and, you know, part of it is I wish we could get rid of MCAS, and that does seem like maybe we'll get rid of MCAS.
It's starting to change a little. Yeah.
We're going to get another test.
It'll be something else, yeah. I want to take this opportunity to point out that every member of the Finance Committee and every member of the Board of Selectmen have this handout that just was published. It was released by the Massachusetts Budget and Policy Center today. It seems to be a pretty common sense explanation of charter school funding and how it's funded, and they do mention both the governor's proposal and the Senate working group's proposal for changing the way school funding is done. I would also like to remind everyone that Stan Rosenberg's legislative session, whatever, is happening at GCC this Saturday. The last time I checked, there was still an opportunity to sign up, and the main topic for the first part of the session is school funding. And the person in, help me out, what's the name of the chair of DESE? Chester Copperbottom or something like that, yeah. Whatever. He will be there in any case, making part of the presentation along with several others. So that's likely going to be a very engaged conversation.
Great.
Definitely worth bringing the Muhammad out to the mountain here. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, great. Another topic I think well covered. Free cash target. Obviously, we saw the recommended budget that came from your department through Doug and has 100,000 set aside into stabilization and a resultant free cash number of 268,000. Mm-hmm. So I'm just curious if you guys, as that budget was coming together, had a particular number in mind. Think we should have a particular number in mind. We've had this conversation independently on our side, and that's where I kind of wanted to bridge the gap or discuss it.
Well, we had always kind of supported the 5%, but we didn't know how you felt about paying off the energy loans with free cash or a shot from the stabilization fund. I mean, it really is up to you what you think. I mean, we just pushed it forward with paying off with free cash, but if you want to pay for it through stabilization and keep our 5%, you know, I'm open to that.
We're close to our 5%.
Yeah, close to 5%.
I've got the budget sheet in front of me, and based on the conversation I had with Dylan at the end of the meeting, plus a conversation I had with Jack earlier today where we talked about, you know, what could be done, how that could work. If the board chose to recommend paying off the energy loan through stabilization, and we pulled the money out of there, we could set aside just under $650,000 in free cash, which is slightly under 5%, about 4.9%.
So that's assuming no 100 to stabilization,
correct?
Energy loan paid out of there,
correct?
And that's where you get that right, 650.
Correct.
Okay.
We could set aside.
I don't know how you guys feel about that. I mean, I feel pretty comfortable that we will be generating one-time free cash numbers pretty good coming up, just based on what, you know, talking to Dick Kalaszewski. So, I mean, I could go either way.
The Finance Committee has always had the policy to try to maintain a 5% free cash figure.
Right.
Well, if you got a $15 million budget, that's $750,000. My personal feeling is that we should try and maintain at least $500,000. Now, last year we went down to, I believe, $420,000. Well, that's fine, because if there's some emergency that comes up during the year, like a hurricane comes through and we need the money, at least we have something available. So I think that we should have it. We shouldn't put it all into the budget and expend it, because then we'll have nothing next year.
I agree with John.
Okay.
Well, you're talking...
What's the interest rate on the energy loan?
Currently, the energy loan has been paid for using year-to-year borrowing. I'm not sure what the interest rate on that is. I know it's probably pretty poor compared to, say, a 10-year bond. But we've done that for 5 years, and my understanding is now we need to bond out for that amount if we are not going to pay it off in May or June. If we do bond out the amount, it will likely be somewhere between 2 and 3%, and it'll likely be a very short-term bond, a five-year bond or something like that. But that would be a payment of $60,000 or $70,000 a year or something along those lines. Again, rough math in my head. So.
How much is
the principal on the loan? About
275 divided by 5. Anybody get a calculator?
No, I think he's asking the total principal.
Oh, the total principal. I'm sorry. The total amount owed is $275,700. Right now we have something like, correct me if I'm wrong, somewhere around 1.6 or 1.7 million in stabilization.
1.2.
1.2. By paying it off early, you're talking about $4,000 or $5,000 in interest.
That we would not have to pay.
That we wouldn't have to pay.
We need up all the free cash to do
that. No. We'll actually retain free cash.
Free cash.
Well, yeah, we will be using 275 out of stabilization. That would drop stabilization to slightly below a million. Yeah.
Oh, it did.
If you haven't already, I mean,
well, we were sort of leaving it up to the Finance Committee how you felt. I felt like we were going to generate, sometimes free cash, generating free cash is in question. But I'm pretty confident that we're going to generate some free cash. So I could go either way. I mean, I'm comfortable using up free cash, or I'm comfortable going to the stabilization. Doesn't matter.
And just so, in our last meeting, we did support looking to pay it off. We did not. We were not directed yet, and we did not know yet what the revenue source would be. We're going to, you know, make a recommendation on that as well. That's part of why I wanted to have this and see what your guys' thoughts were on where it was coming from. But I guess the other question that I have is, do you feel that the town's free cash policy, which I'll generally articulate as trying to be around $400,000 or $500,000 with these large jumps year over year, is good, bad, can be done better? You know, because my concern is when you have, I have no problem with the 5%, but because it's so volatile, as soon as that number jumps up, then there's all this cash that kind of finds its way somewhere. And that's my concern, is that every year there's a bit of a race before that number gets back down to $400,000 or $500,000.
Well, I think the problem is that our budgets are very tight, and I like to be concerned. Your estimates of revenue are very conservative. And I, you know, talking with John Cordair and Janet Swem when she was here, we tried to come up with ways that were very, you know, like a rolling 5-year kind of thing. And we tried to be very consistent and be conservative. And I feel very comfortable being conservative. So part of the generating the free cash is because we are very conservative, but I feel comfortable doing that. So that's one of the problems, is we do generate free cash. And
is
then,
it too much, though? Because I agree it should
I
be
know.
Done. You know, I mean, right now you've got, on the revenue side, you know, $15 million. On the expense side, all the school money, whatever it is, it is. There's no extra coming back. So, I mean, you're really talking about the percentage that we're off by, and I understand it's being conservative, is a pretty big percentage.
Yeah, but a lot of it has to do with building permits and, you know, the you know, excise taxes and stuff that are very volatile.
Right.
You know, they're not regular.
Right, and that's where...
And so if... And unfortunately, we are depending more and more on our free cash to cover our operating budget. But so far, we've been able to generate the free cash on a consistent basis, even though it's not a repeating basis. I mean, this which is really important to understand, that it is different. There are different reasons why we have free cash every single year.
Right.
But I don't see any way really to correct that. Without making some being too vulnerable long term. I mean, there isn't a way to correct and be comfortable, in my mind, to be comfortable with our projections.
Right. And
I mean, we've had multiple. We should meet with John Cordaire again, and because he's had the most experience, I would say, over this. But I like being conservative, so I hate to change our revenue estimates.
To give you a different slight or answer on that question, I honestly believe that we should be taking probably $200,000 to $400,000 off the money to begin with and put it into some sort of capital stabilization fund. Mm-hmm. Because we're going to hit, just like the school roof, we're going to hit things like that, and if we don't start putting some money away, and we're going to run into something that we're not going to be able to fix because we're just not going to have the money to do it. So I champion the discussion of having at least $200,000 to $300,000 into a capital stabilization fund. It didn't get a lot of traction in the circles in which I was talking about it, but I recognized exactly what you're saying. And that would take the sting out of a year where we didn't get as much free cash as we thought, because basically it would be a decision to float it or not float it. But that capital stabilization fund should be looking at what do we need over a five-year period, and are we putting enough money into it instead of having to take our capital improvement out of free cash, which is what we're doing right now. No matter how you balance it, we take all the stuff we need for this year and we take it out of free cash. In reality, if we know that we're looking for that in a repetitive type thing and we put it into a stabilization, then to get it back to do the job, everybody has to agree, a good portion of the people have to agree to put that money to that thought process. So I think it would be, I would have liked to have seen it happen this year. A lot of things were going on this year that didn't allow us to dedicate enough time to have that conversation. If you want to have that conversation and want to make those type of recommendations, I'd stand behind you. So,
actually, John scheduled a meeting for May 25th already. I think it's May 25th. You scheduled a meeting already for May 25th
that
for the Capital Committee.
No, I'm talking if you want
plan to for the projects for that, you're talking
yes.
about.
Yeah.
To set aside, to come up with a long-term plan so that we can put some of this extra cash into it, you know, and in the years you don't have the extra cash, you wouldn't fund
and,
it as
and
much.
Understand,
maybe
terminology kills us. Extra cash is not a terminology
well,
that
free
that's
cash.
The problem. It is
we don't
cash.
Plan we don't problem plan is, on having yeah. extra cash or having this out there, but the reality is
extra income
being
whatever.
Conservative. And again, I can remember when we had, you know, a lot more with a lot less, and we cut the budgets down to the point where there was not a lot of free play, and basically it ended up having everybody worried about their jobs, and it wasn't a good situation. We had people that spent more time talking about, you know, their pay and whether they were going to be employed or whatever than we had good constructive conversation. So from my point of view, we need to balance it and keep it one step at a time. And if this is something that's strong, as I said, I have no problem with putting more money into stabilization or taking it out of free cash or whatever. The reality is it's just defining what it is we're using it for and how we're using it. That's the important things, I think, to the townspeople to see that it's transparent and it's being used appropriately.
And I think I agree with both of you, honestly, because, you know, on the, being conservative on your estimates makes sense. I believe that town accountant already backs out what she believes one-off revenues to be, so that doesn't creep into the average. Mm-hmm. I think that makes sense too. The problem is on the other side, we're not taking those identified one-offs and doing what you're saying and putting them into something one-off,
putting them away,
and making sure they don't creep into the operational budget, because we're in this period right now where those last few years, and it looks like again this year, we're having those, we're experiencing those things. And the concern is, let's say you do that for 5 years and then you have a few years of drought, it's going to do this, and we're going to, that's where you're going to have a real problem, and that's where you're going to be back to very tight budgets and people being concerned about, you know, the next year.
So based on that, actually, this is something we actually could do. I think it's too late to do it at any of these meetings that we've got, the town meetings coming up. But we could actually, as part of our fiscal planning for any budget year, we could take a look at those one-off revenues, those bumps in permit revenues or what have you, that because of some large project that happened. We could take a look at those. We could establish and set a policy to say that any unexpected revenues that are directly attributed to a one-off project, whether we get a grant for something or an award for something or a big capital project that has a huge electrical permit fee, what have you, we could actually identify those, calculate the value of those one-off revenues, and then simply create a motion at town meeting to feed a capital stabilization account to that level. So we remove them from the free cash calculation, and instead we're putting it aside. We're saying, oh, this is money I wasn't expecting to have. I'm going to put it in this bucket over here to pay for the building repair that we know is coming.
So when free cash is certified and it goes from X to Y, you'll say, okay, of that difference, this much is kind of the normal course of business money sent back and being conservative. And then this part here, this is the stuff that was kind of not anticipated and should have been anticipated and maybe needs to be handled differently.
Well, I might even go further, because we've got a 3-year period at least here where we know there's going to be some big permit monies coming in. So we indeed could kind of anticipate them or the value of them, but we can still flag those.
Yes.
That amount.
Well, and this is part of why I do support paying off the energy loan, and you can kind of talk about it from whatever pocket you want, but you know, you are in a sense using that, because right now we don't, if we had a large capital plan on, you know, ready to go that we needed to fund, that's where to think about maybe leave the energy loan out there. But right now we have this excess coming in, and if it's not used up, it seems to kind of often get swept away in, you know, the operational budget, and that's my concern about leaving it in, you know, when we come in next year.
Little off the topic maybe, but still it might tie in. Maybe that money that's put aside into that capital budget could start to fund formally a preventative maintenance and a maintenance program. And I won't go pain you all with that, but I, you know, these are formal programs. This isn't just, oh, we'll hire a maintenance guy. But that ties so closely with the capital. You know, I mean, there's three distinct things, preventative and maintenance and capital. And if they're funded and done correctly, it can save us a lot of money. But it's a long-term thing, and it takes an initial investment to get it going.
We've had initial conversations with Kevin Helstowski, K3, our facilities foreman, who is his role primarily is to oversee maintenance of buildings, town buildings. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping that he and Kevin will both be a part of developing that capital plan. And I'm hoping that it will involve looking at our buildings and saying, these windows should be replaced. Mm-hmm. This wood trim needs to be repainted. This brick needs to be repointed down the line.
That's correct, Doug. But don't limit it to just the buildings either. It's all equipment, anything the town owns. It's got to be identified.
Well, I simply brought them up because that's their focus.
It's good. Yeah.
Those things, you know, the three buckets are important, but in reality, we have to pare it down to not make more work for ourselves. Mm-hmm. And those maintenance should be part of our operating budgets, designated out there as these are the things we're going to do on a 5-year plan. It should be, you know, sidewalks. It should be, you know, these are the things that we're going to do to maintain the stuff that we need to do.
We'll get in the problem we're already seeing where stuff is coming to capital that really should be in operation.
Should be in operations, and we should be putting sex number of dollars away for it, because we know that 3 years from now, it's not going to be worth anything.
We
should have timed failures of stuff that we have, mm-hmm. and work towards making sure that we keep that in a, you know, and again, that goes back to looking at, is it really important?
I think it's something we've always had. But it's all part of what I'm speaking of.
It
you
is.
Identify
exactly,
these things.
Yeah, you're
where the value is. Yeah, or
you're spot on with it, but mm-hmm. the thing is, I don't think we want to create another
layer.
I think we need to get people there, and we've worked very hard at this point. That's the reason our budgets are a little bit skewed the last year or two, is we're working very hard to get people to understand that they have to take care of their equipment, mm-hmm. their buildings, their stuff, because if they don't, we can't fix them anymore. You know, that cost of replacing something that...
I wouldn't argue on who does it, but it's accountability to make sure it is
that
done.
That is done, yes.
Yep.
Kevin is inventorying and putting things in spreadsheets that we've never had before.
Really? Good.
And he is really trying to do that kind of stuff.
Well, what he did with the highway department, I think if that he can follow on to that and from there and do that for the buildings, I think that'll be a big help.
Exactly. Yeah.
But he's trying to do that for the roads. We've got culverts. We've got all kinds of things that we really have to, you know, not only maintain, but you have to realize, you know, these extreme events that we have on a regular basis, they are much more wear and tear, like on our roads and our culverts and our catch basins and stuff. And so they have to be hardened, and you have to do stuff more proactively, because it's going to we can't afford the replacements.
That's the problem.
And they don't qualify. The storms are so frequent now, and they're so localized that we don't have the ability to get reimbursements, and we can't afford it.
No.
And so you have to do something. Yep. And so I have to say, Kevin is, I hound him all the time. I'm always giving him information of different committees that I'm on, and he is really doing a good job on trying to organize that and trying to stay on top of it.
That's good.
And partner with different things. I mean, we're trying to be creative, like with TransCanada, the Franklin Conservation District, and Homeland Security, all these different groups. You know, we're always constantly looking how do we, you know, take partner and have their use their resources, get their resources. Mark brings in a lot of FEMA and MEMA stuff, and mm-hmm. you know, and we're trying to do things constantly.
Well, I don't mean to be a broken record about it, but I just know from experience it works, and I'm really looking out to save the town the money. That's all.
I know. Well, I we're hustling all the time for money. Yeah. I mean, we do creating resilient communities. We're partnering with UMass and USDA and Natural Resource and Conservation Service, and it's little money, but it cumulatively it's adding up, and hopefully, you know, in the long run we're seeing much better maintenance of our roads and our right. you know, different stuff that we have.
Well, you guys have been great with your time. I have one quick request question and then one last actual question. The request is, where could we get updated information on there's two warrant articles, one on the Montague legal defense and one on the mosquito abatement. And I'm not looking for you to go through them now just because I don't want to take up that much more time. But we started to talk about one of them, and it seemed like there was an update that I had not seen. So is there documentation or somewhere we can go to kind of – get
well,
some more detail?
This is a scoop on the mosquito thing. Did you get the vector disease control?
I got the first one from you, and it was a plan for testing five.
Okay, that's 11. Yeah, that's $11,000 one. That they're going to do the assessment of the whole town. I'm hoping, as you know, to get the north end done by the nonprofits, and then the five testing areas wherever they are down here.
Oh, so that has not changed. I thought
so.
There
okay,
was...
no, but the mosquito district. The second thing I got is because of the Zika stuff that's happening, the Zika disease. All of a sudden, the state, after 3 years of meetings and going to Boston and being a, you know, the state came through and said, "Okay, you can do the Pioneer Valley mosquito district now." And you saw the assessment; it's like three times, you know, what we were going to pay. I don't even have the numbers right here. I don't think I have to look for them, but
it's about $44,000.
Yeah, it was a huge amount of money.
Okay.
So, and the problem is, you know, we've done a lot of research on this, and the mosquito control district, it comes off in your cherry sheet. You don't have much control of it. We would be a voting member. We'd have one vote, and all of us, but the state really controls it. However, the reason why there's a letter of support for on our agenda tonight is because the federal government didn't use all their Ebola money. You know, for the Ebola crisis, they allocated all this money. And so they're turning it over towards Zika and control, and they're the federal government is also raiding different pockets of money. So there's going to be a billion to $2 billion available in the next couple months for Zika mosquito control. And we're not sure how it's going to come through. So what we want to do is say that we support the idea of the mosquito district. We had this meeting yesterday. This is all brand new information. I had a Homeland Security meeting in the morning, and then the Western Advisory Group, which is a Department of Public Health meeting in the afternoon yesterday. And in between, a lot of us are on the same committee. So we had this, our mosquito control meeting yesterday, our little mosquito group. So our mosquito group decided that we needed to send this letter of support because we're not sure, number one, none of us know how bad this Zika disease is going to be, you know, once it gets circulating, because they don't have a vaccine for it. And it's not really, they originally estimated that it would be 2020 before the mosquito that carries it comes up to Massachusetts, but now they're downgraded it to 2018, and the Asian tiger mosquito that we already have here does carry it. So it really depends on the circulation of the disease, because it also spreads through sexual transmission, so sexual activity. So nobody knows, number one, how to what extent it's going to be circulating in the population. Number two, we don't know if how long it really stays in sperm. It's supposed to be 60 days, and then now they're talking 10 weeks, and it's in the bloodstreams of women for longer. So, you know, than originally estimated. It changes almost, well, it's definitely weekly. The information changes. So nobody knows to the extent that it will be circulating. So what we decided as a group yesterday is that all of us would send letters of support for the mosquito district to the state and say, yes, we are interested in the mosquito district, but the price, we can't afford the price, because everybody's price is three or four times what this VDCI came up with. So one of the things that we think is the price driving the price difference is our VDCI is willing to use the lab at UMass, Dr. Rich's lab that does our tick testing, and he uses grad students, and it's totally legit. It's a state lab, but it's just not recognized by DPH. So when DPH does the trapping, they send everything to Boston, and it's in being processed by this one lab, which is going to be overwhelmed by the amount of people that are trapping. So the turnaround there is like 7 to 8 days, and it's more expensive. Whereas if you go through UMass, which is legitimately a state lab, they do good work, and we have a good connection with them. He just spoke to our meeting, our MAPCO meeting last week, and they're more than willing to do our mosquito testing. The turnaround, if you did a Monday, they could probably have the stuff, the answers to you on like Wednesday. You know, it's like a 2 to 3 day turnaround. And it's cheaper because it's right here in Amherst. You know, whoever does the trapping, which just drives to Amherst, drops it off, and the testing is quicker and cheaper. So, but if this gets out of control, we don't know what the prices of this VCDI is going to be ultimately if Zika turns out to be this real epidemic. So what we want to do is send a letter of support saying we are interested in this mosquito control district, but we can't afford the price. And then what we do is we just go back and forth until we get a bigger handle on what is actually happening with Zika, what's happening on the state level, because none of us, from West Springfield up to Greenfield, none of us can afford what the state has said they would be willing to do the mosquito district on. Right. So,
can you repeat your question?
Are there two
different proposals?
So I'm asking more. Obviously, this is interesting to me from a town perspective. But then on the warrant article, like more specifically, is there going to be a warrant article? I believe there is, for the $11,000 for the testing.
Yes. Okay. Because ultimately, that's what we're going to sign that. Northampton and Amherst and West Springfield, they've already actually signed on with VCDI.
Okay, can you let him finish his question?
Oh, okay.
Well, we found out which issue you're fired up about this year.
Okay. No, but it's just that we have to do something.
Spazzy is the better.
I was just going to go fired up.
Yeah, we have to do something.
But
this is
again,
part
of
climate
change.
So
what's the funding level, $10,000?
$11,000.
Okay. Is there going to be a warrant article related to this other letter mosquito district that is just something that the select board is sending on behalf of the town that we have interest but cannot afford it?
Right.
Right.
Okay.
This is because we don't want to say no to the mosquito district because, number one, we don't know if there's going to be federal funding or not. And if there is federal funding, that might be the only way to channel it.
Okay.
We have no idea how explosive the Zika might.
Sure. That's next week. We need to deal with the 11,000
okay.
one.
So,
we brought it up and Doug, I think, had heard something about this other one and so thought that there was something different. And so this clarifies.
There's parallel processing happening.
Right,
apparently.
Right.
Right. But there's no money.
Well, we want
to
keep our options
there's
open.
No money
and
for the
obviously,
second part
we want
at
to
this point.
Take all of us are. Our budget constrained.
Okay.
All of us want to do the best thing for public health.
Right.
So we're just kind of being
flexible. Is there a place that we can go to get more clarification on the Montague defense warrant item? Because I know very generally what that's about, but.
Okay.
And you do not have to provide it right now. If it's somewhere, I want to save your guys' time because you've been very gracious to give us this much time in your meeting.
We're definitely going to need to have some information for next week's information session.
Yeah. And we'll get it to you before it goes to the information center.
Okay.
Yeah. What I can do is, I can say what they have expended so far.
That's not necessary.
Yeah, it's really.
The lawyer representing us is okay with this as long as the language doesn't tie them both together? Is that our understanding?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Christabel has signed off on the warrant article.
Okay.
And there's no, we're not actively in court right now,
right.
So there's not even any issue at all.
Okay.
He was just worried that it looked like we were going to go to court,
mm-hmm.
and he didn't want us to intervene so that we would be subpoenaed deposed.
Is there a history of towns appropriating money to fund other towns' lawsuits? I just don't know. This is different. Like, I haven't looked at something like this before, irrespective of what the suit's about. Just
in that general,
have we done this as a town or have other towns around kind of done this before?
Not unless you've created an organization that you agree to pay money into before it starts. It's never been picked up on the backside,
right?
To the best of my knowledge.
What this is doing is I'll have to
I have
the money somewhere. What it is Deerfield and Montague were our ratepayers for Berkshire. We were the only ones that were would have basis to be interveners. So when we're going to work together and split the costs. And what happened is that we, Christabel was worried that at the time he didn't want us to file anything to be an intervener. But Montague said, okay, they would go ahead and do this for everybody and, take the lead on this and go ahead by themselves. And the idea was that, the other towns, which were always going to contribute to the Deerfield-Montague effort, are ending up supporting just Montague.
So was there a promise made to Montague to pay this?
We had intended to intervene. That there was no promise of any amount of money. It was just that
we were
going to support them.
The Board of Selectmen as a unit did not
We just said that we were going to intervene with them at some point, and then we backed off.
There are other towns that are, according to Carolyn, are giving money to Montague. We can look at that if Doug will get the information as to how they're doing it and what it looks like, and see if there's been a legal challenge to it or something, if that would be helpful to you. But
I think the process is fine. It was really just more how we got here, what conversations led to this.
Gill and Northfield have already allocated $5,000 on this current year.
But it hasn't gone through the town meetings yet, has it?
Oh, no, it has. They already voted it in special town meetings.
I think, as well as at a special one. Is it Northfield or Conway at a special?
I don't know if it was a special, but it's on Conway's regular town meeting warrant. It's on Leverett's regular town meeting warrant. It's on our regular town meeting warrant. There are several other communities that are contributing.
Okay.
It's $20,000 to $30,000 to $40,000 for the expert opinion person to go through the correspondence, and then the lawyer. I know that Montague's already spent about $15,000, and they've allocated another $10,000, I believe, for their lawyer. And really what it is to go through the correspondence to show that the moratorium was, in fact,
Fabricated,
actually, yes. That it was based on false premises.
If they're found guilty, or if this is false, is there a penalty that would pay us back for that? Money invested?
I would assume that we would be able to, that Montague would make a claim to get the money back, yes. But basically what you're doing is showing that there was no contract need. It was a falsified need, and therefore there's no basis for the NED pipeline. And
basis for the NED pipeline or for the moratorium?
For the moratorium.
Moratorium that would give us, but the pipeline ultimately is based on the contract.
Sure, I understand.
So.
Okay. Well, that's obviously a little different. That's why I wanted to...
The moratorium in this area has nothing to do with the pipeline, because the pipeline said that it was not going to stop here anyways.
The timing was just odd, though.
Well, Berkshire is now owned by Columbia Holding Company's owner in Connecticut, and Berkshire had already had a plan for 5 LPG tanks in Whately, and after, I think, the first tank, they froze that project, but they had a DPW approval.
Five more than the 5 they have now?
Huh?
5 more than the 5 they have now?
5 total.
I think it was a total of 5. They poured the slab, apparently activated one tank, and then stopped and declared a moratorium.
I think they're all out there.
No, they aren't.
Okay, I'll have to go look. Mirage.
All right. We'll talk more about this, and I'm sure this is where the public information session for the budget will, I'm sure, be very, very helpful, just to give people a heads up.
I'll have all the information. I'm sorry I don't have it right here.
No, okay. No worries.
I had it. Like I said,
those are ones I just wanted to know where to get the information. The last question I had was on, there's a couple articles about funding for wastewater treatment plant. And removing some of the language or changing some of the language for the ways in which that can be funded. And the reason I want to bring this up is that what's come up both in one of our meetings and outside of our meetings from other people to me was, will some of these changes be done in conjunction with any larger, broader changes to the way that the wastewater treatment plant and its budget are handled? And that's, I guess, my question is, I see kind of the micro. I see the couple of specific things we're looking to do here, and I'm curious, again, as that this is meetings for, is kind of what's kind of the macro as we look at that situation. Obviously, I understand the projects being talked about, that this flexibility may be needed, especially flexibility with regard to grants, which makes a ton of sense. But there was some concern about adding flexibility for general appropriations, and I was just curious if there's any other moving parts in this conversation.
I wouldn't mind speaking to that, okay. And you can stop me if I'm speaking out of turn. The expectation of that language change is to allow the town, as the operator of the wastewater plant, to receive grant monies, which some could argue that this language would prohibit us from doing. It could be a stumbling block that could stop a grant application
If the grant source says, oh, you've got this language that says you can't accept grants, then we could be declared ineligible. That being said, I've also been talking with Kevin, with the folks from Weston and Sampson, with the folks from Dave Prickett Consulting, who's doing the sewer rate study, and also with our town accountant about the possibility of establishing formally an enterprise fund for wastewater operations. Historically, the town has operated the wastewater department as an enterprise fund, having all of the costs, including benefits for employees and electricity and all operating costs being paid for by sewer user fees. By creating the enterprise fund, we formalize that. And it actually makes us, requires us to do all of the accounting in its own bubble, if you will. So there you are.
Did that answer your question?
Well, the part about the grants makes sense. I think that flexibility is an important part of what we'd be looking to do. I think the concerns that have been raised by some have to do with the additional flexibility of potentially appropriating town funds, taxpayer funds, towards projects, and that, you know.
Well, let me maybe help you out with that.
Sure.
The language that's in there was put in there as a, and correct my terminology correctly, basically it was a...
instructions to officers.
Instructions to the officers. It wasn't done for any major reason, and the reason it was put in there is because it was instructed by the annual town meeting, which has the authority to make these changes and do this. Any of the language that's in there does not take away that belief or that ability for decision making. It's not short-circuiting anything. It's not giving the sewer whatever their title is, sewer commissioners any right to perform taxation or do anything different than it's done in the past. It's strictly to clean up the language. I can guarantee you that at some point in time, the sewers are going to have to be addressed, and it's going to be a conversation that's going to get down into the nitty-gritty of whether we're going to extend sewers or allow expansion of or anything of that nature. But that's to be decided by the annual town meeting and the people of the town. This is not what Doug is recommending here is not to short circuit that, because whatever we do in the future is going to have to go to town meeting floor. And if it's in the best interest at that time to make changes, we'll recommend them to be changes. Nobody's going to do anything in a bubble. It's going to be a long, drawn out process to figure out where exactly we're going to go. But yes, we have to do something, because the sewers facilities, the sewer treatment facilities themselves, are in dire need of work being done. And we will be looking at who the responsible parties are to pay for them, and you guys will chime into that just like you do every day. It's going to be on the table for us to discuss how it happens and how it transpires. But it's way too mature to actually start thinking of that end run when we're not even sure how far we're going to take the process of working on the sewer treatment facilities, whether it's an enterprise fund, whether it's going to be a turned over to somebody else, whether we're going to regionalize, and because it's been suggested because of grant money, regionalization, it could be anything. But I can assure you that it does not take away the town meeting's vote to do what's going to happen.
That wasn't the genesis of my question, but about taking away town meeting's vote.
I just want to make sure we're clear on this point. By eliminating the language that's existing now, doesn't that give the, well, it's not only the select board, whatever, the town voters, mm-hmm. doesn't that bring that to the floor as far as being able to assess not only the users of the sewer, but non-users?
Yes.
And I guess that's what the concern is for some people.
Okay.
As far as actually having a discussion about that,
mm-hmm.
and I understand that there's value. There's no question about it. I'm not saying that there isn't, but I think to remove this language, you know, instead of adding, you know, acceptable grants or whatever, let's include that in the existing language to change it to, in that form. But to come out and ask people to vote on this language change without knowing all the ramifications that could come down the road.
Well, I think that's what our meeting in a couple of weeks is to discuss that, and you can bring it up at that point in time
next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday, yeah. That's what this is all about. But right. I hear you, and I understand you, and I've told you this many times. I thoroughly understand that what your point is.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is that we have to fix the system.
Well, I understand.
And we're going
to
have to do whatever. And when the facility was put in, I'm sure that there were angst about how it happened or who paid for what or in the all aspect of it. If we're going forward for a full-blown, it's going to mean a lot more than whether that language is doing it, because basically it's going to be betterment charges. It's going to be more people on the sewer systems. It's going to look at the big picture. And that doesn't stop or help or preclude. And the conversations you're having are going to be the ones as to, are people paying their fair share? And you said there's value, but the value now is in question as to, is it fair? Yeah. And we're not addressing that in this discussion. Mm-hmm. We're not looking at the money aspect of it. We're discussing words. And the reality is it fairly assessed to the people who use it? And we have some work to do. I can't tell you where it's going to take us for sure, but I can tell you that it's going to be more fair and equitable, but it's got to be fixed. However it gets there.
Right. And I agree with that, Mark. I'm not arguing that point at all. Well, it's just about how we go about that. And right now I see there's, you know, I have a list of unanswered questions here that I really do believe that need to be clarified before people vote on this.
Would you submit the list to Doug?
Yeah, I'll
so that basically
I'll do this
instead
up.
Of having this type of a dialogue when we get into that meeting, we could put fact sheets out so that people can talk about where the facts are.
Right, yeah.
And it would be very helpful to actually just have that.
So we'll do that.
Doug, we can address it.
Right.
I want to give the counter viewpoint on that one.
Wait a minute, hang up.
Yeah.
Bruce Hunter, I was wondering if the selectmen have thought of putting together a separate sewer commission?
Absolutely.
Any thoughts?
If anybody came forward and wanted to volunteer to do that job, the Board of Selectmen would probably stand up and yeah.
It should be a separate commission.
It was, originally. And the reason what happens in this town is when nobody else will do the job, I've been the deputy dog officer, I've been everything else. If somebody wants to stand up there and say, hey, let's do this and let's put it on the table and work through the... Again, it goes into the voting, it breaks it out. It's,
let me raise
it's
your
no
arm.
Different than a separate Board of Health.
As long as it's on the table.
Anybody that wants to bring it forward as a motion at any town meeting, it is great. And I think that's part of what the instructions officer or the other is to look at a different type of agency. I am criticized because I sit on a bunch of boards, which I do not do them justice because I sit on way too many of them. But nobody else is coming to the table. You've got to figure out how we get to incentivize people sitting behind this mic and explaining and figuring out how to fix things. Because they aren't going to get fixed by themselves, and we can't leave the seats vacant. We found that out in a real hard way. Yes, Bruce?
As an incentive, you could do what Sunderland does and offer rebates on taxes to people that, elders that work on boards. You would get a lot of people that are unemployed or not employed, currently retired, come and work and have the expertise you need. I think that's a way of solving the solution.
I want to thank you for putting me on the spot.
I can actually speak to that. There are models where a certain percentage of property tax can be paid for in donation of time and service to a town. The town of Deerfield doesn't have something like that established yet, but that is something that we've at least in a sort of side swipe have looked at. And if the board wishes, I can get with the town clerk and the town accountant to find out if that's something.
Actually, Linda Dumas sent me a little over a week ago all the information, so I will forward it to you because I was going to look, I knew it was too late for this year, but we were going to look into it for next year.
That would have to be funded through any budget. If you're going to do that, you're going to have to provide funding for it.
No, because it's reimbursed by the state.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
It's a state program.
It's a state program, and it's reimbursable through the state.
That's a new one.
We could match it.
Because Chapter 44 requirements that we looked at when we did the veterans breaks and the other ones was it came off of the tax rolls, that basically they were not paying taxes into the roll.
No, Linda sent me the thing.
It may have changed, but we've looked into it in the past, and the issues that we have is the fact that you bring more people in here, you got to manage them. And the thought that we need to do is have good job descriptions in place before we add people to people who aren't handling.
What I told Linda was that, you know, there's lots of filing and stuff like that, and you know, you certainly could do, from a filing point of view, you could get that someone to do that reliably. But some of the other things are a little bit more difficult.
I mean, we have tons of projects. If you just talk about digitizing the facility, we could get the volunteer help to come in and do that at a cut rate.
Supposedly, the state reimburses us for whatever we...
An article in the paper just the other day that recorded that addressed that. It was up to $1,000 that seniors could earn for their taxes, and supposedly the state would reimburse that.
I'd be interested to see that.
I don't know, because as far as if there's a limit, a dollar limit per town, but it's something to maybe look into.
It's definitely
I will forward it to you, Doug. Thank you.
Basically, we'd use them on the senior center. We could use them in...
Right, exactly. There's several areas that we could...
Yeah, they could utilize it, but we took and looked strong at it about 9 years ago, and we enacted a couple of things that dealt with veterans and some things with seniors, but it wasn't the work for, because we honestly believed at that point in time, and I still think this until we get our ship shape, bringing more people into the offices is not going to create a better environment at this point in time, but... I mean, if we can...
We're working on that as best as we possibly can.
We're doing a great job. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to say that this is a reason we...
Please not this week. Thank you. Yes.
It's stuff that didn't hit the table this year, but it's on the horizon for things that we think when we get things in place.
I did tell Linda that we would look into it for next year.
Thank you very much, Bruce. Sorry, John.
Two things. Number one, on my resume, I always enjoyed putting down deputy dog officer.
They took it away from me. I'm not qualified anymore.
They took it away, I know. But we used to be deputy dog officers.
Yeah. I'm actually really happy not to get dog calls, John.
And the second thing is I wanted to say that we have a disagreement with Mr. Upton about major sewer funding methods. And when we got to do this headworks project, which is going to be around $1.2 million, I just want to point out that typically we get from commercial businesses in this town 20 to 25% of our taxes, which is $2 to $2.5 million every year, and we should be using some of that money, and however you split it out amongst everybody else, for years all these commercial taxpayers have been supporting all the residences. So I think all the residences could give back a little bit towards supporting a sewer project, because that's why South Deerfield has grown the way it's grown, because people come here for the sewer. They don't come here for anything else other than sewer. They either go to Old Deerfield to the schools, and they want the schools up there, and they want that pristine environment, or they come down here because this was kind of the manufacturing base for the town of Deerfield. And if you've taken a look around, if we didn't have sewers in this town wouldn't be half the size it is right now.
But I think that you're both talking about the same thing, as coming up with a fair and equitable way of paying for it.
I agree with John.
And that's right. There's
value there.
There's value, we just have to figure out what the formula is, how it works
exactly
out, and the process. But the reality is, this is
true.
This is something that we got to dig our teeth into. We have to really focus.
And my last comment on the sewers is, don't move too fast.
John, don't worry. Number one, the money is overwhelming. But
I know it is.
Number two, we really are trying to look for grant money.
That's fine.
But there are things that.
But there are things that can be done, should
be
done.
There are things that we cannot, because right now we have some liabilities I'm not really comfortable with. I would like to say that basically the headworks is going to take away a good chunk of that liability and thought process, but it's just the start of it. And moving too fast, we got to have a big plan. We have to have a master plan for this process so that basically everybody understands where we're going in it and they can vote for it, yay or nay. I don't mind keeping things status quo if people want to have the moratoriums and we want to slow down the pipes and we want to do things that will make it just last another 20 years or something like that. I don't mind, but that's the vote for the townspeople when they have all the information.
Well, what I'm speaking to when I say slow down the process is when they came up with a dream world of starting to ship some of our sewage over to Greenfield and then accepting sewage from Sunderland coming across the bridge, I think some of those things are kind of far-fetched and out of the line.
John, it was only because there was an opportunity for a HUD grant, and that's why I came up with it. And I didn't even ask for enough money. I thought $20 million sounded pretty good, estimate, and it was really going to be like $30 million.
But we didn't get it.
Slow down and make sure we can afford whatever
John, we didn't get it, okay? So it's off the table anyway. But if we were going to get a grant, we had to regionalize, and this was one way to regionalize and get things fixed.
This is an example of us looking under every rock for the ability to get something accomplished. I didn't hold much, I agree with you, John, that I didn't hold much stock in it, but we have the two issues, the two plants that need to have something done with them. And it's not a maybe, it's a you have to set, even if you slow it down, you got to fix it to slow it down. So, I'm not recommending slowing down. I'm just saying that we have to look at the big picture. We have to get the people who know how to deal with this stuff and move forward with it.
Mark, you're right on the spot, though. The master plan was one of the things I had, one of the questions I had.
Yeah.
And it's got to be there for it to move forward. Right. The language there is inconsequential in where we're going.
I came across a document, actually, Kat pulled it out of the files. She's been going through a lot of the files in the office. And I believe it was
1981.
No, it was 89 or 98. Maybe I'm transposing the numbers, but it was a sewer expansion study committee.
1989.
And at that point, a lot of these same topics were being discussed.
Yep.
How can we expand the sewer? Who's going to pay for it? What advantage will it provide to the town? And I'm not sure what happened to that committee.
It died because of lack of records.
It went back into the file drawer.
We found one record of one meeting.
It died because of lack of money.
Okay. I do want to just reinforce that we are talking about a broader plan. We're focusing on what needs to be done in the short term, but we're talking about a broader plan. We're looking at MassWorks funding. We're looking at USDA, RD, rural development funding. We're looking at actually adjusting the way, making recommendations to the sewer commissioners as to how sewer is assessed in a more fair and equitable way, not only for residents, but also for businesses. And we're looking at creating capital stabilization or capital pockets of money that can be used for capital upgrades. Right now, with the design monies that is being proposed to be used for the Headworks project, we've bled down the sewer reserves to $200,000 or so. One component at one plant can cost $250,000 to replace if it fails. And my understanding is that there's three of them, and all three of them are at least 20 years old. So it's a pretty terrifying prospect.
Yeah.
We definitely have to start by increasing the stabilization funds available and then moving forward. So we are going slow, though, definitely.
John, and the only reason I was after that, it was an opportunity that money was from the Sandy money, and, you know, the HUD grant was for mitigation needs from, they weren't met, and it was a one-time deal, so, but that didn't pan out, so, I mean, that's off the table. That was only because we needed to bring in low-income, you know, communities, you know, Greenfield and Sunderland.
I mean, now I can't afford to continue living in town.
But you're right, though.
We were hustling. We were trying to hustle.
Public sewer system, natural gas, and public water.
Yeah.
Crucial. It really attracts people.
We still got a great town, and we have some issues to deal with, but the issues are minor compared to the greatness of this town.
It is.
We do tend to work together. We tend to disagree occasionally, but in the end, we still end up with good products and good people, because that's what we have here.
I agree.
Well said.
Well,
have anything else?
That's a good one to end on, I think.
Yep, that's
the end. Can we go home now?
You're the chairman. You take credit for it.
He needs
yes.
a motion.
Oh, yeah, can I get a motion for us to so move?
Second.
Before you guys go, let's just reiterate to everybody that's out there, and next week, next Tuesday, at what time? 7 o'clock?
We can do it at 6:30, but I think we said 7.
Okay. I think 7 is better, because you guys usually meet at 7, right?
Yeah.
Do you want to do 6:30? I mean, we can post it at whatever.
I unfortunately am not going to be in town next week. I'm very sad, but to be missing the 12th. Our meeting next week is on Monday, the Finance Committee.
Okay.
You guys here, 6:30 or 7 works better for you.
What do you guys want to do?
Either or.
6:30 is good for me. Right. You know.
So it'll be 6:30 Tuesday here for the public information night. Okay.
My heart.
We'll miss you, Dylan.
Yes.
And then we'll talk
budget
about the articles. Yeah.
Articles.
And we're going to go over everything. This financial. I guess we could go over everything that's.
My hope is to have draft language for the warrant articles. To have the numbers for capital investments and everything else in place and presented. We'll have handouts.
Was there anything from last year that people want to improve upon? Was there any suggestions, or did you like the setup last year? Did that seem to work for everybody last year, where we went over everything just line item?
Yeah,
I think it's
helpful for going into town meeting.
Right.
Okay. I think the biggest benefit is this year, I think we have a lot more information together at this point than last year. I remember anyway, it still seemed extremely in flux, at least on the Finance right. Committee's perspective. As this year, I think we've done better to beat back the timelines a little bit, which is positive.
The budget's a little bit more stable this year.
Broadly speaking, I'm asking both the board as well as the Finance Committee. My expectation is that we'll be looking at essentially an expanded version of the summary sheet that you've been receiving. The detail sheet. It lists every bottom line for each department all the way down the line. But we're not going to break out into each department's budget and look at specific
right.
information.
Right. Right.
The police department has
about.
This amount of money. Their request
right.
is
yep.
an increase at this, and broadly summarizing any major changes.
Correct.
And then people can ask questions, I guess.
Yeah. Right. You don't want to overload.
Yeah, because it'll just, the time factor will.
Yes. That's actually its own warrant article in the special town meeting for some of it, and in the annual for the rest of it.
Do we have something each Tuesday?
Yes.
Will there be recommended amounts on the omnibus
yes,
budget?
Absolutely. It will essentially be a breakout of the handout that is normally included with the warrant packet
right.
at town meeting. So it will include, I think the expectation is it's going to include the request and then the recommended.
So we have all the questions that you have on the budget. As you've reviewed it now, you've given us what your concerns are and what the questions are.
You were going to give, Jeff, you were going to give.
Yeah, I will. Yeah,
but that has to do with that article.
Right.
But on the budget
yeah,
itself,
I'll,
we
I'll
have
bring
all.
Bring that to Doug either tomorrow or Tuesday.
Yeah, but
I mean, Friday.
Not Tuesday.
But as far as the budget goes, for light items or issue, you've covered the things
we
that we really
everything.
Need to address or have
Yeah, I think we
have an answer on.
Again, most of tonight was bigger picture. There was a couple that touched on specific budgets, but of the remaining budgets we have to vote, I think we're in position next Monday to do that.
We stumbled over Tri-Town Beach, and hopefully in the future.
Well, Doug was going to chase to hopefully get more information.
Trying to chase down that information.
We've definitely got some issues to chase that to ground. I mean, it's a small.
Dylan, we still have to vote to adjourn.
Right, we had it seconded, so all those in favor?
Aye.
I'll forward.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Dylan, I'll forward you these draft minutes so you can use them for the minutes.
Perfect.
Yeah, it includes times.
Bill, you want to answer everything?
Huh?
We should set up a GoFundMe.
Board of Selectmen is not done yet, though, correct? Okay.
Take it easy. Have a good one. Thank you. Appreciate the input.
Doug, thanks for the minutes.
Touch base tomorrow if you can, or the next day, whatever. That'd be good.
Dylan, thank you very much for putting it together. All right.
Thanks, John.
Continue on with our budget. I mean, on our budget, yeah. On our agenda. I'd like to go back to the approval of meeting minutes. I'll take a motion on the minutes.
I make a motion we approve the minutes of the 10th, February 10th, February 11th, February 24th, March 9th, and March 18th.
I'll second that for discussion. I've read them all. I have no problems with them. And for us to pass these along, we just need to vote them. I thought it was one I wasn't present for, but I don't think so. I don't know. But for spirit of getting them accomplished, all in favor? Or any further discussion? All in favor of them?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just wanted that small disclaimer because we only have two people that can vote them, even if somebody, usually we don't have people that are not at the meeting
Mark,
vote to approve them.
I think
I was. I was looking to see it.
You participated remotely, I think, at one of the meetings. I think it was the 11th.
Yeah.
No, I'm sorry, not the 11th, but there was one meeting which was on Friday and you participated remotely.
Okay.
But that's okay. That still is.
Yeah, but I think we can.
Legitimately, I think you can still vote on that.
Yep, we normally don't. We leave it to the people that were there, but it's kind of hard to pass it with just one person. So, all right.
Standing? Does that constitute a report? No, I don't think so.
Select board comments. Can you give us an update on the RFP?
For?
Skims.
South County EMS, the RFP, I need to get it to you, and I apologize. I should have printed out draft copies of it for you, unless I did, and I may have. I don't know. Do you have it?
I didn't.
Is it in your packet somewhere?
I don't think so. It's not listed, so I didn't go looking for it.
The RFP is complete. It has gone through review by Sherry Patch, Town Administrator of Sunderland, Mark Pruhensky, Town Administrator of Waitley. It's also gone past both Zach Smith, Tom Feidenkevitz, who's a selectman in Sunderland, and Bob Ahern, I think that, is that his name? Bob Ahern, who's the chair of the Board of Oversight, all with positive approval for it. The one comment that Tom Feidenkevitz said, though, is that it should come before the Board of Selectmen in Deerfield, as Deerfield's Board of Selectmen is the awarding authority.
Yep.
If broadly speaking, if you can agree to take a look at that, and as long as I get at least an informal sign-off saying, yes, this looks good, run with it, we can go forward right away. The timeline for the RFP is going to be about a month from beginning to end. We are going to actively pursue options. We'll be sending this out to interested parties, any that we can think of. And, of course, we're going to try to advertise it as best we can, both by statute, we have to put it in the newspaper at least once, but we're going to try to promote it as best we can through our website, through Facebook, and we encourage anybody to come and pick it up and see if it's something they can help us with.
There are some developers that Dick Kalaszewski has spoken with who are interested in at least reading it to see if it's something that they can help with. And I think the more people that have eyes on it, the more open and transparent the process is, and the better the result will be. So that's where we're at.
Can I have a motion to approve it as long as two signatures are on it after review?
Yep. I make that motion then. I'm fine with it.
Authorize?
Yep.
Sending it out? Okay.
Is that a valid motion?
To authorize the issuance of the RFP.
With approval signatures?
Pending individual review and approval by, and authorization by signature. How about that?
Yep. You agree with that?
Yeah, I'm fine with
that. I'll second that motion. Any further discussion?
No. I think...
All in favor?
Aye. I think there'd be enough eyes on it that it should be okay.
Well, it's what is being recommended by the
right.
people
and that's
who
why
use
I
it.
Feel like I'm okay with it, because even though I'm not...
Well, please take a look at it, because
yeah,
there
oh,
is a
I will,
Deerfield.
I will. But I feel like there's enough people
look
looking
at it, right?
at it that it should be okay.
I can have Brenda, a look at it. I
would you please, through our financial people, look at it, just so that we're not missing something?
Okay, sure, yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
The ambulance, the senior center, I haven't had a meeting yet. I have no negative things and haven't really heard anything that's happening. We had, it's just going along fine. I can't give you any updates. Tilton Library, they're looking at still the general informative meeting coming up. They've got good prints that have come back with recommendations for space.
When's that meeting?
I want to say it's next, hope it's not next Tuesday.
I hope not either.
Can you find out when the Tilton Library's needs assessment presentation is going to be?
Okay.
I think it's going to be in this room, so it can't be. We won't have this room if it's
there. Was one that happened in this room a couple weeks back. Is there another one coming up?
I've been getting emails indicating that we were going to do something else. I hope I didn't miss the meeting.
I don't know anything about it.
Yeah. Well, sure. I think we need to get, you need to get a look-see at it. Because
okay.
It's going to be a significant event if it happens. So you need to get to look at it. Anything from the Board of Health?
Like I said yesterday, there was enough of us between the two meetings, hanging over between the two meetings and coming to the meetings, that we had our little mosquito group together, and we decided that strategy as a support letter. So I was hoping that Doug would send a letter, that we would vote and authorize Doug to send a letter of support for the mosquito district, but saying that the cost was prohibitive at this point. Was there anything they could do, kind of thing?
I'd be in favor of that, as long as the letter has in there that we're in support of the concept.
Yes.
And I don't care if it references the money, just so that we have that. We know that we have an issue. We're supporting us.
Well, what we wanted to do was say, all of us wanted to say that the issue was money, because
yeah.
None of us can afford the cost of it. So we were hoping to ask them to relook at it, and by then some time had gone by, and we would
I'm
getting some answers on some of this other stuff.
My biggest concern is, you know, three times the dollar value to have the state do it. Even if the federal people gave us the money, it's not worth it. The time frame doesn't matter. So I'm not in favor of just the money issue. I want a good product for the people that are here. And the people in Boston, and I have a lot of friends that work for the Department of Public Health, they're in a whole different world when it comes to what we need and what's acceptable.
Well, like I said, one of the issues that We think that it's based on the cost of testing it at the DPH lab, but we also have a problem with the turnaround time. You know, they have a turnaround time of 6 or 7 days. Well, if you captured a mosquito that is got triple E, and it takes 6 or 7 days to confirm that mosquito has triple E, that's 6 or 7 days that our residents are potentially exposed to triple E. And the whole important reason why you're trapping is to say that, okay, this is very serious. You need to make sure there's limited exposure for kids or whatever, and you know we can cancel sporting events if it's dusk or whatever because this is very serious. Mm-hmm. But if you're waiting a week, I mean, kids could be bitten by then and infected, and I don't mean just kids, but kids are more susceptible, and that's what you think about because they're out at dusk or whatever and running around, and so. I'm very concerned. So we were concerned about the turnaround and the testing, but also the money. The money just makes it so we can't do it. But on the other hand, if, like I said before, if the federal government is giving money through mosquito districts, then and Zika takes off and we have no ability to fight it, but we're not getting any funding either, then we need to say we're going to do the district. So we just decided to be flexible by sending a letter and not committing. So if you are okay with that,
I have
okay.
But I want you to understand what I said is the fact that, you know, I agree with all that.
I think Doug gets the idea.
The only thing I want to make sure is that basically we agree with the concept, but they're going to have to improve for us to be fully bonded into it. So I want those.
We didn't want to blow them off. We didn't want to blow them off, but we didn't want to commit either.
Right. I don't want any commitments out of this until
they
come to the table with something better.
Right.
Can I consult with you on this tomorrow at some point or the next day?
Yes.
And any other information you can provide?
Yes. I have.
They probably have a mosquito district. They already have a sample letter for you. I wouldn't worry too much about it.
If that's the case, great. But
no, there really isn't. But
however it works.
Because we just yesterday got together.
It's no different than our letter of supports.
VDCI, was just signed on they just signed a contract with the CDC to do the southern states. So if they're working with us, then they're potentially, you know, that funneling of money might be able to be funneled to them direct. Yeah. So, we just wanted to be flexible. So I will get with you. Jean Galloway from West Springfield was going to email me her letter of support that she was going to send, and then you can just base it on that.
As I told you,
there
will be a letter. Oh, trust
me. I'm very
me.
Happy. I have no problem cribbing off of someone else's work.
They will. We can plagiarize and just change the names to protect the innocent, but just, you know, don't worry too much about that because, as I said, somebody's already written the letter.
What's the saying? Good writers borrow from other writers. Great writers steal outright.
Well, Jean is sort of like our chair, she's the lead person on this. Sure. She's the West Springfield is the lead community. Okay.
So do you want to make a motion to send a letter of support?
She did, and I seconded it for conversation, and then we want to vote on it now?
Or you can just agree that you voted.
We agreed. I don't care.
Yeah. Okay.
Very good.
All right. Anything else from the Board of Health?
No, I because it's freezing out, I didn't want to bring in the mosquito traps, but I figured I have you can take soda bottles and make your own mosquito traps. So we're going to post it on the website, and I was just going to show people how to do it. It's real simple.
You do a video.
Well, it's very cheap.
Mr. Collins, it's okay. Go for it.
So the best thing to do is
not
you
tonight.
Patrol Carolyn. Your yard.
Carolyn, no. Not tonight, please.
Patrol your yard for water, and then we'll put out these mosquito traps.
Shovel the snow out of your buckets of water, and then...
I know. That's why I didn't bring it, Mark. You should be happy I didn't bring it.
But no, he's got a very valid point. Let's get with Chris and get a video or something on it and get it on FCAT. That's a good thought process. But let's...
It's made with brown sugar and stuff. It's real simple stuff, and you can put it in.
All right.
It's real effective.
Enough.
Very effective. It works.
All right.
I beg to ask the same question again, but is there anything else for the Board of Health?
No. Well, do you want me to just, I can mention that I testified at DPU last week, last Wednesday, when there was that SCEMS meeting. And, public officials didn't, I didn't even get to speak till almost 9:30, but it was a long hearing. But basically, I just talked about that there was three things legally that had to be overcome. Article 90, Massachusetts Constitution, Article 97, which is your conservation lands. The Attorney General is defending and willing to seemingly go to Supreme Court. So that's quite a long legal battle. Our own battle for cease and desist order, which is Mass General Laws, Chapter 111, Section 31 and 143, the powers under our Board of Health. And then the final one is Mass General Laws 114, Chapter 17, which is our cultural, archaeological and cultural resource laws. And Bud Driver's has been doing a magnificent job of giving all the documented information and sending it down to FERC and the Kinder Morgan contractor. So it's very well documented, and those things have to become overcome in court before the pipeline is allowed to go through. So that it's significant. The other thing is, I've already talked to Michelle Camosa, that if the pipeline is permitted, they have a meter station on 5 and 10 just north of historic Deerfield. So she's willing to lead the team, and we will probably use our medical volunteers from our emergency dispensing committees to do health inventories of the people, just really on the 5 and 10 corridor down to like Michelle's house, because the meter station doesn't have more than a daily, not more, it's not supposed to be even daily, but not more than daily release, and it's a small amount. It's not like the big compressor stations. Our worry, so we'll see how that goes. We'll use the health forms, that survey forms that our information day that we had here at Frontier a couple months ago. We'll use those forms, and we'll work with UMass School of Public Health. They are actually going to be doing Northfield extensively. They're connecting with the town of Northfield now, and that will be all set up because of the compressor station. So, like I said, there probably will be a compressor station somewhere in the Conway Deerfield area once the pipeline is up and operating, and we'll just not worry about that until the pipeline is actually built. And we'll base on whatever Northfield did for their health survey, we'll do another health survey here for impacted households once the compressor station, that secondary compressor station, is sited. So, but we'll worry about that if the pipeline is actually permitted. And so I'm not spending any time on that right now, other than lining up for the metering station, because that has already been designated in Deerfield. So that's as far as I got for new information on the pipeline. And that's the last meeting of where we were on the health surveys and lining up with the School of Public Health at UMass. Apparently they're willing to do that. So that's a huge expense that once you get the baseline information, that's huge on how you can mitigate whatever's happening at compressor stations. Mm-hmm. So having UMass being willing to work with the towns is a huge relief, because otherwise I don't know how we would finance that. I mean, that would be quite a lot of expense. So we can do it with volunteers and grad students.
Very good.
And so I guess that's it. That's the latest update.
Thank you.
From our MCAP meetings this month.
Very good. We have a review and approval of the host agreement. Have you had a chance to look at the final draft?
You know, I read the, you know, I didn't get in here early enough. I was going to come in to read it. So Doug from the original? Is there any, what are the changes from the one that we had last?
The bulk of the agreement is essentially unchanged. What is changed can be summarized in the first, basically the first two sections. There are some very minor details which actually protect New England and Patient Network in the case that the project is not approved, or in the case that the dispensary fails or later on closes down. It allows them to opt out of the rest of the portions of the agreement. However, most of the changes are in part one of the agreement. Upon approval by the Department of Public Health for the licensing, the final licensing of the facility, NEPN agrees to make a payment to the town in the amount of $50,000. I think this is down from, I think the initial payment was going to be 100 in one of the first drafts, so it's down to 50,000. Based on gross annual sales for the first year after the commencement date, and the commencement date is the basically the Department of Public Health approval to operate. Okay, yeah. Based on annual sales for the first year after the commencement date, a second payment to the town will be equal to 2% of their gross annual revenues derived from sales out of that retail location, and that payment shall be due 1 year after the commencement date. There will be another payment for the second year equal to 2% of gross revenues, and in the third year there will be a payment equal to 3% of gross annual revenues, each payment due at the end of those years. This agreement is a three-year agreement with the option to renew, which gives the town the ability to, or gives the Board of Selectmen the ability to sign the agreement without town meeting support necessarily, but any renewal will likely have to be to go before the town meeting, I think. I could be wrong on that, but I'm pretty sure that's the case. The remainder of the agreement is, for the most part, as it was initially. It does provide some protections related to if NEPN becomes a nonprofit, if they become eligible for status as a charitable organization, they will make the assessed fair market value tax payment directly to the town as an additional payment under this agreement. In other words, if we can't tax them, they'll still make the payment anyways, basically a payment in lieu of.
How can we have a bill due before it's done?
My understanding is that, at least my understanding as to the way this is supposed to work, is that the $50,000 payment is due right away, and that the commencement date of the operation would be the commencement date of the agreement. And that commencement date, the expectation is that that first year revenues, it may be a partial year, it may be a small amount. The second year revenues should be a full year worth of revenues, again in the 2%. And then the third year is there's the escalator clause up to 3%. Based on their models for revenues, 2% of first year is something around 60 or 70,000. Second year revenues are going to be at least double that. And third year revenues will be, again, above and beyond that. And that's using conservative numbers, their conservative numbers.
Well, my question is, we're asking them to give us a check before they finish the year. If you're asking for a check, the first check you get,
yeah,
that's on.
But that's $50,000. That's as soon as they get their license.
They get it.
Yeah.
But you want a check, by what you said, and I assumed you were reading it, you want a check for the first years on the first year anniversary of the commencement.
It's only going to be partial.
It may be lower than a
full. I'm not hearing my question. Okay. You're asking for the check to be given to them basically within the time period of which revenues will be calculated. And unless their systems are a whole lot better than anybody else's, they're not going to know what the first years are until they close the books on the first year. And the check would have to be due at some point after they close the books.
No, because this would be gross revenues. So they would have a record of their gross revenues immediately.
Okay.
So the 50,000.
There's no adjustment. It's based on gross revenue.
Mm-hmm.
So right. if they took in 10,000 a month, they would know at the If DPH gives them June 1st, mm-hmm. so June 1st, but they don't actually open until December or September, say, we would not get a full year, but on June 1st.
You're not answering my question. This is a frustration. If we're closing the books on May 31st, which is 1 year, at the end of the day, you expect all the revenues for that year to be calculated and put in.
Well, they would have a monthly revenue, and so they would probably give us the check, you know, like June 10th or something.
I understand that that's how it probably would work, but the words say that you will provide it within that year on the anniversary. Give them the 10 days or give them the month or whatever it is.
I see what you're saying. So this payment, so in other words, changing the language to say this payment shall be due 30 days, 1 year and 30 days, or within 30
within
days.
Within 30 days of the close of the commencement.
So in other words, give them time to close their books and do the math.
Right. Is all I'm saying. Fair you know, enough. Give them 15 days. I just, the way it's written, somebody goes after that, we're going to end up in soup over.
This is, they agreed to this, Mark.
Okay, Carolyn.
It was their lawyer.
Okay.
I mean, you would know at the close of business, I would assume.
My understanding was also, though, that the $50,000 payment would be due when they get their license, but
yes.
that the 1 year of retail sales. Whatever, let's say it started on March 1st of 2017, that would start the 1 year period, mm-hmm. and that at the end of that 1 year period, that's when they'd calculate 1 year worth of revenues, and that's when the payment would be due for that.
Right.
Actually, I'm not sure that this actually reflects that intention.
I don't think it does, but I mean, if their lawyers are good with it, they can figure out how to give us a check, and I'm sorry that I brought it up.
No, Mark. I understand what you're saying, but it's like, if they're okay with it, what the heck?
I would actually suggest maybe putting this off until the next meeting.
Did Lisa look at this? Lisa looked at this.
Lisa
right?
has looked at this over time, but I'm not sure if she's looked at this final iteration. So that's the.
Oh
other
well,
thing
if she hasn't looked
on.
At the final, then I don't want to sign it. I thought she had already looked at
so
it.
So let's call this a second reading, and we can move on. Yeah. I do want to get the clarification as to when those payments would be due. And like you say, allow a buffer time or a pay period.
Just some sort of common sense type thing of saying, hey.
Yeah.
But if this is legitimate ease, and that's the way it is, I have no problem with, if there are no changes, authorizing the signing at our leisure.
Why don't we do that? So, because I'm not sure when this is due, because...
I'd like to get it out the door as quickly as possible.
They do want to get it out the door so they can proceed from there in the final stages of getting
it. I know.
License.
I don't want to hold them up.
I guess my motion would be that we approve the grant agreement how do you phrase it?
Upon
the completion of approval of legal counsel and addressing of
our concerns about
pay processes.
Yeah,
we have no problem with the agreement. It's just the mechanics of how do they pay it before they calculate it. But anyways, if that's good, if that's common practice, I have no problem with it. We'll sign it at our leisure.
And I second that. I was just concerned that we. I think they actually need it. Don't they need it this month?
Yes, but I think that's a doable thing. I can take this and send it to Lisa Mead very first thing in the morning and make sure she's got approval on it. I'm actually going to modify it to make sure there's a place for legal counsel to sign off on the signature page. And I'm also going to make sure there's a place for town accountant to sign off.
Okay.
I was reminded that no contract issued or agreed to by the town is valid without approval by town accountant.
Okay.
Basically signing off to the state, and in this, you know, for appropriation purposes, but...
Yeah, no, that's fine. So, I mean, I'm just as soon collect another $50,000 too, but I don't want to hold them up.
Okay. Moving on, Eagle Brook has a Chapter 61
first right of refusal and a waiver of the 120 days. It's been formally submitted to us.
Yes, it has.
And
I think we just have to, we have to read it, Mark, I think. I thought I saw that.
It's a letter to me. It's not a...
It is a letter basically requesting a waiver of the Chapter 61, 61A lien on the land, and a release, I'm sorry, of that lien, and a waiver of the 120-day waiting period.
But I thought there was a form that we had.
We have to do a form, and we have attention? And we have to read this out in public. Was it posted?
What do you have? It's posted on the agenda.
It's posted on the agenda.
Okay, so then we, it's posted on the agenda. I'm not sure if that meets the...
We should check to see that it does.
Yeah, I think you have to, because it's a public hearing. We have to hold the public hearing and read that letter in public, the request, and then we vote.
Okay. The documents are ready. If we feel that we need to do a public hearing, then
we just have a public hearing that is part of our board meeting. It's not a special one.
That.
We just post it and we go into a hearing.
Post 7 days in advance.
Just check with Lisa if you're going to be talking about
yep.
the.
Okay.
It's just that this is. I'm not sure if this is correct, but.
Yeah, I agree with Carolyn. I think there's more than that, but the thing is...
I don't have a problem with it.
If it's not required...
I know we have to read it, Mark, so let's read it. Yes, let me read it.
The letter?
Yes, you have to read the request.
Just the thing I did, the request.
Notice of intent not to exercise option under Mass General Laws, Chapter 61A. The town of Deerfield has been duly notified in writing in accordance with the provisions of Section 14 of Chapter 61A of the Massachusetts General Laws of the intention of by Eric Malloy of Eagle Brook School as counsel for said school to develop land that is currently valued, assessed, taxed on the basis of its agricultural or horticultural use pursuant to said Chapter 61A, and that said land is a property described in a deed recorded in the Franklin County Registry of Deeds in Book 1954, page 315, as attached to this notice and is further identified on the Deerfield Board of Assessors tax map, map 42, lot 7, containing 69.182 acres of land, which is more particularly described in a plan of land recorded in Franklin County Registry of Deeds in Plan Book 59, page 89. Please be advised that the town of Deerfield will not exercise its option to purchase said land for fair market value in accordance with said Chapter 14 of Chapter 61A, and hereby waives the 120-day period during which such option may be exercised. In witness whereof, we, the undersigned Board of Selectmen of the Town of Deerfield, Massachusetts, hereby set our hands and seals of the town the 6th day of March 2016. So you're making a motion?
Yes, if it's legal to facilitate this at this time, I move that we do so. If not, we change the date and bring it back at a.
And I second that.
Scheduled.
And Mark, so
call it meeting.
Yep. So now, I vote aye.
Aye. So we can sign it. You know, if they're good.
Yep.
We'll sign it. We'll come in and sign it at our leisure. If it's not good.
You can ask.
I did also hear one typographical error that I'll have to correct, so don't sign those. Yeah, I'll fix that.
So that needs. Okay.
Oh, yeah. I apologize. I'll need to correct that.
All right. We'll sign it when we sign the host agreement, I guess.
If we can. Are you going to talk about Chapter 90 money in your report?
I was going to briefly mention the fact that we did get notification from the state in relation to our Chapter 90 funds. Confirmation from the state says pending final passage of the bond authorization, the FY17 Chapter 90 apportionment for the town of Deerfield will be $396,310. This apportionment will automatically be transferred into your existing 10-year Chapter 90 contract, which is available at such and such website. They recognize that the Chapter 90 program is an integral part of maintaining and enhancing our community's infrastructure and is an essential component of this joint partnership. And the MassDOT looks forward to working with us for the coming years to continue the success of the program.
What? How much did we get last year? I was just going to look it up.
I do not know off the top of my head.
I'm just going to look it up.
I didn't think it was.
It's usually, well... I don't see it.
I don't think so. It's always been kept as a off books because it's not part of appropriations.
Yeah, it's not in the actual
budget.
We can't use it
for
anything except road repairs.
I was thinking it was here. They were listing it, but I don't see it at all. Yep.
And
I just was curious what we got last year, Doug. Okay.
Okay.
I think it's about the same, but I'm not sure. Be helpful to know.
We had correspondence about Lions Day.
Yes, and actually that's something that I was not aware of, and I apologize for this. This did come in very late. I would not bring it up except for the timely nature of the request. This is from a letter from the Deerfield Lions Club, specifically from Pam Hodgkins, who's the president. She says, on April 12th, the Deerfield Lions Club celebrates its 70th anniversary of the founding of the club. And they're going to be postponing the celebration dinner for that anniversary until mid-May or June, as most of the folks are involved in getting the classic car show up and running. That's going to be held on July 16th. So they're going to postpone the celebration dinner until mid to late spring. But they would. The request comes in saying, I would like to ask that the Board of Selectmen issue a proclamation or citation naming April 12 as Deerfield Lions Day. As soon as they've confirmed the date, they will be sending an invitation to the Board of Selectmen to their celebration dinner, at which point the presentation can be made.
Wait, they want us we're going to have a meeting here on the 12th so we could actually read the proclamation on the 12th.
You can read the proclamation there on that day, sure.
Yeah, so why don't we do that, plan to do that. Is that okay with you?
Yeah. All right. Make a motion to, I thought read we would before have to do we have, two steps. One is we say to do it, and the second one is they bring it to us.
Oh, okay. I make a motion that...
work up the document there. Yeah,
yeah, we don't have the document to read, so... Yeah.
I know, but I didn't assume that we had to actually vote on that, but you're right.
I don't know if we do or not. I just...
Well, I make a motion that we absolutely proclaim April 12th as Lions Day, and that we actually read it on the 12th before our joint informational meeting next week.
Excellent. I'll second that. Any further discussion?
No, other than to say thank you so much for a great community.
Everything
group.
You've done.
Yep.
From the first ambulance to...
I one of the things that I especially love is the lighting of the Sugarloaf at Christmas time. It's pretty.
Deerfield Lions Day.
Okay. Doug, anything else for us on your report?
That I do want to reiterate that I've had a tremendous amount of support from Kat Dolan in the office, and we are digging through some pretty amazing back reports and documentation from back around 2-3 decades. But she's been a tremendous help in getting a lot of those materials sorted out. This is going to come up. I would be happy to show this to you afterwards. The Board of Assessors has come up with a final recommendation for a pilot program for the Lake Street Development
Partners solar project. It's not a true pilot. It's more like a structured tax agreement. This would be an agreement that would allow Lake Street to pay money in lieu of paying for personal property tax on the solar development. It provides for a high year one new growth figure for the town, which helps the town in the longer run, but also provides a managed and predictable taxation for the developer, which makes it easier to go out and get funding for the project. That being said, there you might have comments or concerns about it. So as soon as we're done with the meeting, I can make copies and you can take a look at it, or we can just review it informally. And that does not have to be approved at this meeting, but should be taken up on April 20th before town meeting, because it will have to be voted at town meeting.
Okay.
Can give copies of that to the board of to the finance
committee. I will.
So yeah, they can look at it and see if they have any recommendations.
Absolutely.
Anything else?
I have nothing. I was expecting to spend a lot of this meeting doing finance committee collaboration, and I thought it went well. So
I think they did. I think they did a great job.
Thank you for providing as much information as you did, Doug.
Sure.
It was hard to have informal conversations.
Do you have anything else?
No.
I'll entertain a motion to adjourn with the signing of the warrant.
That sounds good to me. So, yes.
I'll second it. All those in favor? Or any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.